That combined with data from the NCAA over a five-year period, which showed that female athletes suffered concussions at a rate 70% higher than male athletes, together speaks to a risk of girls playing boys hockey at the high school level. In addition to the safety issue, there are social and logistical issues that the girls deal with on the boys' team. When the team travels to away games, the team is given one locker room, which naturally is used by the boys. The girls use whatever other space might be available, which at sometimes in the last season was a bathroom or a closet in the rink. And even when a spare dressing room is available, the girls are still separated from the team and end up feeling like outsiders on their own team. So allowing our NHS girls to participate in a girls' ice hockey program would address these issues. There is no downside to the budget neutral proposal you will hear tonight, and I ask you to please support having NHS join the girls' ice hockey co-op this season. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Jeremy Whalen.
Hello, Jeremy Whalen, 214 Pomeroy Lane in Amherst, Massachusetts, but I'm a technology teacher at Northampton High School. And I'm here later to formally talk about the student improvement plan, but I just wanted to thank a couple of people who really helped navigate the donation and the renovations that we made in our room. It's a long process. And there's a lot of different components moving to make sure that it's not only are we going by the book, but it's a safe environment for the students to be operating in. And so thank you to Ms. Walczak and the superintendent, and especially Brian Labardi as well as the fire department, for coming in and ensuring that, you know, everything, all the spec, we were up to spec, we were up to code, and we were doing everything by the book. If you come into our room and see the renovations that have happened, you're going to see a classroom probably that you haven't seen before, and I'm truly appreciative of all the work that the students helped put in to make it a reality, but also more importantly what the students have brought just with their intrinsic motivation with our new program that started as the yearbook. Last year I had a couple of students that were kind of in the yearbook class, but this year we've expanded it to cover communications and media production in a really comprehensive way. It's very student driven. We have student leaders that are picking the stories, deliberating on the possible angles, the possible consequences of their reporting as well. And they're truly doing a phenomenal job. Just in the past couple months alone, we've gotten interviews entirely student produced with Jill Stein, presidential candidate, Solomon Goldstein Rose, and other individuals, both from politics but also within our school, to hear the voices of our students. It's really been an environment in which the students are taking ownership for their work and are improving both their education and their local community. So I just wanted to thank everybody that was involved in that process to make sure that we were kind of dotting our I's, crossing our T's, and we're doing things safely and productively. So thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. The next speaker who signed up is Blue Duvall.
Hi, my name's Blue Duvall, and I live at 38 Sandy Hill Road in Florence. Coming up on the ballot pretty soon is the idea of charter schools. And the reason that I bring it up is because it's been giving a lot of thought as to why people would send their kids to charter schools. My oldest daughter I sent to public school because there were issues and I didn't feel that my daughter was cared about as far as a person. There have been a lot of changes. That happened at JFK years ago. She's 26 now. And I feel that there's been a lot of changes. My youngest daughter, just left JFK. I was very, very, very happy with JFK. I felt that they cared, that they were very responsive, and I went into the high school. Now, it's not been a smooth transition in any way. I think it's respect and caring and feeling like you matter that keeps people at a school, because let me tell you, I wanted to leave Northampton so badly, but my daughter said, please, can we just make it work? She was recommended by her Spanish teacher here at JFK to take Spanish 3. She was recommended, as was like 5 or 6 other students. And yet, towards the end of the year, we were told that just uniformly, unilaterally, they just said no. It was told no by the principal at the high school that we were not going to have that program. They could not skip Spanish 2 and go into Spanish 3. Well, I contacted the guidance counselor who told me to contact the principal. So I contacted the principal in July twice, never heard back. And I thought everything was fine, so they put her in where she was recommended. Well, finally, Sharon Carlson said, well, you should just call and double check. I assume, since I hadn't heard that it was going that way, it wasn't. Anyway, it was a very big fight to get her where she was recommended. And I was told that the high school's challenging. I didn't feel my daughter was cared about. John, Dr. Provost, cared. He knew what she was capable of. The principal didn't know anything about her. It was just a policy. And since then, that policy, my daughter was the first one, and we had to fight to get her in back in. And then the second one was, there's 3 kids in there now, but there were 6 that were recommended. I think that vertical alignment matters. Another thing I wanted to say is, I have 3 things to say really quickly. So the other thing is that Ward 6 representative, I listen and I watch. You're not the representative of Ryan Road School only. You're the representative also of Bridge Street School. You're the representative of the high school, my daughter, or of JFK. There's many different schools that, as the Ward 6 representative, you're my representative. I'm Ward 6, you know, for all of it. That was another. And then the last thing I wanted to say is I just came from a game, and I had to miss almost 20 minutes of my daughter's soccer game because of my dog. It says no pets allowed. I explained to her that it was to Cara Dupre, finding out that it was a service animal, and I was told it didn't matter. I showed her the law, and I have the law on my phone. And I sound like I might be on the verge of tears. I mean, it was very, very frustrating to stand there. I finally called the police. I said, you know, I mean, how can I get in? Do I have to call the police? And she said, well, you can do what you need. So I called the police, and then I realized I had Dr. Provost's phone number, and I called him, and I got to go in and watch my game. But I think that respect and caring and consideration and making people feel like they matter matters. And so far, the teachers are phenomenal at the high school. I do want to say that. I'm not here just trashing. The teachers are wonderful, and that's going wonderful. But so far, I'm not happy with the lack of what I consider to be just respect, just common respect. And
I just want to say
I didn't want to have to come and say all of this here, but it's the lack of power. There's no place to say it because people don't listen. It was just very frustrating to stand outside of my daughter's soccer game and not get to watch her because she didn't feel like watching. I mean, I showed her the law. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you, Blue. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in public comment this evening? Okay. Seeing none, I'll move on to the next item on the agenda. Are there any announcements from members of the school committee? Okay, hearing none, I'll move on to the recommended actions section of the agenda. And we have specifically a vote on a consent agenda. That consent agenda includes the approval of minutes of the negotiating subcommittee of September 15th, September 28th, 2016. It's the Rules and Policy Subcommittee minutes of September 29th, 2016, the Negotiating Subcommittee meeting of October 3rd, 2016, Budget and Property Subcommittee October 4th, 2016, as well as 2 field trip requests, the NHS Cross Country Teams Twilight Cross Country Invitational in East Falmouth, Mass, October 15th, and the NHS Cross Country Teams Bay State Cross Country Invitational in Gardner, Mass, October 22nd. And I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the consent agenda is adopted. Now we turn to our reports and recommendations, and we turn to a report from the student representative, and it's my pleasure to welcome and to introduce our new student representative from Northampton High School, Elena Fragamini. Elena?
Thank you all for having me. So I'm Elena Fragamini. I'm a junior at Northampton High. I'm from the student union. We chose amongst ourselves a representative to the school committee. I was chosen for that. So the NHS Student Union is a new governmental body of Northampton High School. It has four representatives from each class. Class officers still handle class events, fundraising, Booster Week graduation. The student union provides a fundamental link between the students and the administration, a path for that communication. It's a voice for the students and seeks to make positive change at NHS. So we are a new body. We're still seeking freshman representatives so that we can become a truly representative body of the high school. We're looking for avenues to get freshmen on board. Recently, we polled NHS students online about the issues that were on their mind. Some of the issues that came up were gender-neutral bathrooms at NHS, the junior lunch policy, required AP testing policy, just things that were on their mind. The highest vote-getter was the senior end-of-year dismissal date. Around 250 students participated in the poll, and we look forward to working with our principal, Principal Lombardi, to just kind of assess what students feel about these issues and make sure that we're representing them. So in other news, the high school now has a student news broadcast, the transcript, which I work on. It's run through the Northampton High School Technology Department's Communications and Media Production class. That's the revamped yearbook course, which Jeremy Whalen spoke about. It's released weekly, Friday mornings, on nhstechnology.org. Some of the segments cover sports, arts, controversial issues around the community. We also, tonight, the NHS Fall Theater production Proof is happening. So it's happening tonight, Friday, and Saturday night and afternoon. Tickets can be bought at brownpapertickets.org, .com, actually. Again, this is a student-directed production. It's our Fall Theater production. Also, Booster Week starts next week. The float parade this year is significant in the fact that it is going to a girls' soccer game, whereas previously it has gone to a boys' football game. Also, NHS will be having a homecoming next Saturday. It has not previously, for the past couple years, had a homecoming dance, so we are all excited for that. And again, thank you for having me. I'm super excited to be on board.
Thank you, Elena. Okay, the next item on the agenda is a presentation. It's about the Bridge Street School Library renovation. And I believe we have, Principal Choquette is here, as well as some other folks who will be joining her for the presentation.
My name is Amy Tolson. I am a Bridge Street School parent, and I'm also the treasurer for the Bridge Street PTO. I'm here to introduce the library renovation project. My clicker is not going.
And it's going to be.
All right, you got it?
Hope so.
All right. You can move to the next slide. Maybe we just have this slide. I can keep going.
Fine.
Fortunately, I'm a teacher. Give me a piece of chalk and I can do this forever.
Laura, can you come to
this? Should I wait or should I just keep going?
I wait.
All right.
This is the
Oh, look at that.
Jeremy.
This spring, both myself and Principal Chiquette were approached by Tim Van Epps. Tim Van Epps is a Bridge Street School parent, and he's also the president of It Takes a Community. It Takes a Community is a nonprofit organization that supports community building and educational projects in Western Massachusetts. He was interested to see if It Takes a Community could support Bridge Street School, and asked what we thought would be the best use of a donation from It Takes a Community. Both Beth and myself instantly replied, yes, the library would really appreciate that type of donation. So over the course of the summer, we developed the library committee, and you can go to the next slide.
Want to try the remote one more time?
We got it now, yep. Okay. The library committee is composed of Principal Chiquette, myself, teachers, staff, parents, and our new librarian, Sue Cornell, who is going to take the presentation from here.
Thank you. Are you advancing?
Yep, this is.
Okay, thank you. Hello and good evening. My name is Susan Cornell. I'm the librarian at Bridge Street School. And as you just heard Amy state, there are many people who would like to see Bridge Street School undergo a library renovation. So at this time, I would like to take you on a tour of the library to show you where we are presently and where we would like to go. So what is wrong with the current library? There's a lack of open space, as what you're looking at right now is the nonfiction section of the library. And to the right of those shelves is where myself and other people conduct story read-alouds and whole group instruction, and as you can see, it's really not comfortable, and there's not much space for everybody to sit. The space is definitely not wheelchair accessible or handicap accessible, and it should be by law. This is a picture of a stairwell that goes downstairs and is unused at this time and is taking up much needed space that we could utilize better. The furniture is very big, too big for our youngest learners, and students often have to kneel on chairs to reach the tables, and it's very heavy and very hard to move. This is a picture of the circulation desk, which is outdated, and it has exposed wires that students can, our curious little minds like to goof around with. This is the computer lab that is currently housed in the library. And like the furniture, it is too big, and our younger students reflexively kneel on the chairs to reach the computers, and it takes up a large portion of the library. And there are also bookcases that I just discovered the other day that I had not seen before. They're on the left of that screen underneath the computers that we could be using. This is an unknown residue on many of the bookshelves, and this really needs to be addressed as soon as possible. And it is on many of the bookshelves, and we're not really clear what it is. We think, you know, maybe it's mold, but it's raised and it's goopy, and I can't scrape it off, and I just don't, I don't know what it is. So this is the collection. Oh, excuse me. These are the shelves. This is the nonfiction shelving. And they're really too high. The titles are not visible, and they're not accessible to the students. This is a picture of one book in the library. Our collection is very limited, and I mean very limited, and it's very outdated, and it does not reflect the diversity of the Bridge Street School community. It does not support inclusivity, and it does not support the development of literacy skills for all our students. I did a collection analysis recently, and the average age collection of the average age of the collection is from 1977, but with many books much, much, much older than that. This is a summary of the problems with the addition of old rugs, which are causing health concerns, including asthma and allergies, and we also have outdated fluorescent lights. This is the community engagement survey we conducted, which includes ideas and comments from students, staff, and parents. This picture in the upper left demonstrates that students think much of the collection is too old, and the picture on the lower right is of the reference section, which, according to one parent, is clearly the weakest part of the school, which I can attest to. Listed in order of priority, and based on the survey we conducted, these are the improvements parents and staff would like to see. And these, here are some additional areas of improvements that are wanted and definitely needed. We'd love to have a lending library for parents and an early reader section for kids that are learning to read. So our vision, we would like to create a 21st century learning common space. We would like to transform the library into an engaging learning center. And this is an example of a comfortable collaborative learning space with right-sized furniture for kids and technology that is easy to operate and student-centered. This is a makerspace area where kids can get creative, inventive, and learn. It's where we would love to incorporate a STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and math program, and we'll house our really exciting new 3D printer, and our software, electronics, craft, and hardware supplies, and more. And it will be a great space to use for our Genius Hour. And we would also like to improve our teacher resource room, which we currently have in the back office of the library. And this is a dream big slide. And this is the anticipated timeline. And so far we're on target because tomorrow we're having an environmental study done and a sketch of the current library. And there you have it. So this concludes the current state and the vision portion of the library renovation presentation. Thank you all for your time. And now Principal Chiquette will speak about the financing and the funding opportunities.
Yeah, I don't think I need that. Thanks. Good evening. So as Amy said in the beginning, we were approached by Tim Van Epps from the ITAC about what we could do for our school, and both of us chose our library. And the ITAC has given us a donation of $100,000, up to $100,000. We would also do some additional fundraising. We have money through Valley Gives of the $2,750. We have a private donor donation, which I believe is on the agenda in a minute, of $1,500. And then we have some other possible fundraising that we could do through the Davis Foundation, the Community Foundation of Western Massachusetts, and then through our local businesses such as Florence Savings Bank and the Big Y. And that concludes our presentation, and I know we're up next on the agenda.
Could I just ask a quick question related to the presentation? I think the lights are coming up. They're there. I just was curious. I know you're still doing the initial evaluation. Do you have a sense of what your budget is at this point, or okay? Go ahead.
Yeah, so right now it's about the $100,000 and then the two other donations that you see up there.
What I meant was, so you're going to try to tailor the design for the budget?
Yes.
Just curious about that. I didn't know if that was money toward a larger project.
Our hope is that if we can renovate the inside, then we can gain momentum on raising funds to update our collection. So the $100,000 we're hoping to put towards as much renovation of the physical structure, and then the PTO's goal this year and next year is to raise funds to update the collection.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, thank you so much. Thanks for the presentation. Okay, next up, as luck would have it, is a vote to accept a gift from the It Takes a Community Foundation. Of up to $100,000 for the Bridge Street Library renovation. And could I get a motion so we get that on the table? And then
motion to accept the gift that takes a community foundation for up to $100,000 for the Bridge Street Library renovation.
Second.
Okay, so there's a motion made and seconded. Did you want to just, again, you sort of explained it, but
Yes, so that is obviously our big chunk of money to start off with kind of the structure of the library. And we're very thankful to Tim Van Epps and the ITAC Foundation for making this happen for us. So thank you.
Dr. Baird.
So I've spoken before about how great it is to have makerspaces and STEM type programs across the district, including at JFK and at Jackson Street School in the budget last year, and for the robotics program at the high school, so which are curiously not at Ryan Road. But I'm really excited to see the makerspace as part of the project. If you're looking for like an additional grant or additional funding towards that kind of program, the Haunted Foundation, I know, has been very generous in providing STEM-type materials. And that might be another source of funding.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Other questions or comments?
I'd just like to say this is great. As a 1983 graduate of Bridge Street School, before the renovation and that library was put on in its current space, it's always great to see exciting things and renovations happening at my old school. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
You want to confess any overdue books? maybe the fines can pay for the renovation. Okay. Well, and again, I'm a Bridge Street parent, former Bridge Street parent, so it's great to see this the space being updated. So good luck in the process.
Do you have any overdue books?
What's that? No, I don't. I don't.
Thank you.
And I want to also, it's so exciting that we have elementary school librarians who are collaborative and have the wherewithal to help with a lot of this stuff. It's really exciting to see what's going on. It's really, really great.
So there's been a motion made and seconded to accept this generous gift. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Thank
the
you.
Gift is accepted. And then we have another gift, so stay there. This is a $1,500 gift from Melissa Madison, and it is for the biography section of the Bridge Street Library renovation.
Yeah.
Make a motion to accept the gift from Melissa Madison in the amount of $1,500 for the biography section of the Bridge Street Library renovation.
Second.
Okay. There's a second. Did you want to expand on this?
So Melissa is a parent who is involved with our PTO and wants to help out the library, and our biography section is lacking. So she made a donation to specifically put towards our biography section to help update that.
Okay. Any further questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So the gift is gratefully accepted. Thank you
very much.
Next, we have a vote, and this is a vote to authorize a co-op with the Long Meadow Girls Ice Hockey Program. And I would recognize our athletic director, Kara Dupree, to discuss that with us.
Thank you for your time this evening. On behalf of the Northampton High School Athletic Department, I request your approval to enter into a girls' ice hockey cooperative agreement with the Long Meadow High School for the 2016-2017 ice hockey season. The purpose of the cooperative team is to give young women the opportunity to skate and compete with and against other young women. Additionally, the goal is to increase participation among females in the sport of ice hockey and to increase the number of female teams across Massachusetts. Currently, Long Meadow hosts the only public high school all-female ice hockey team in western Massachusetts, which includes players from Westfield, Minichog, East Long Meadow, Ludlow, Sabus International Charter School, and Agawam. The anticipated participation number from these schools is 22 student athletes, and I anticipate Northampton will add 3 student athletes to the roster. Some of the aforementioned schools have extremely competitive ice hockey programs, thus limiting female participation over the years. The very nature of ice hockey as a collision sport creates disparity in access and participation at the high school level, which is unfortunate given the increased level of interest at the youth level. The Nonotuc Youth Hockey Program, which serves students from the Northampton, East Hampton, and surrounding areas, currently has 29 girls from pre-K to 12 registered for the 2016-2017 season. Nine of those young ladies are students who live in the Northampton School District. Amherst Youth Hockey, which also offers programming to Northampton students, had 75 girls attend Try Hockey for Free Day last year, and one-third of their registered student athletes pre-K to 12 are female. Amherst Youth Hockey is also sponsoring an all-girls team ages 8 to 12 with varied levels of skill. Additionally, there is an all-girls youth team out of Springfield and Enfield that area girls can access. The youth programs are on the rise, and they have quite a few options, and hopefully they will have more. But unfortunately, we don't see that same opportunity once they reach the high school level. Given the limited public high school ice hockey opportunities, the trend is to leave public schools and attend prep school if you are really engaged and invested in your ice hockey experience, or to simply leave ice hockey behind after the age of 12. My hope is that we can offer this opportunity to our young women and they do not have to make that tough decision. I have specific information on the organization of the team and the financial implications, so I can continue or I can field questions about those areas.
Okay. Do we have any questions about the program?
I have two questions.
Sure, Mr. Moore.
Where will they practice?
Sure. So the cooperative team plays most of their home games at the MassMutual Center in Springfield. And they practice at either the Olympia Center in West Springfield or the Westfield Arena. They travel to the central and eastern parts of the state to play their away games. The families understand that transportation to Olympia or to the Westfield Arena or to the coach bus that will take our student athletes to the other parts of the state are their responsibility.
And my other question has to do with down the road, if this grows, is it a complicated thing to split into a couple of co-ops or?
It's not, and I'm actually glad you asked this question. I was on the phone with the athletic director from Amherst today, and he had been speaking with the executive board members for our Pioneer Valley Interscholastic Athletic Conference. And they were talking about how the interest in Hampshire County is increasing, and so he'd like us to look into in the future developing a Hampshire County all-female team that would help service Greenfield area as well as Amherst, Northampton, Belchertown, et cetera. And then also the cooperative team through Longmeadow would remain, or they could split off and continue growing girls hockey in this area.
Other questions about the hockey co-op?
Are you going to continue with the financial piece?
Yeah.
Okay,
yes.
So I won't ask any questions about that right now.
Okay.
We are currently in a cooperative agreement with East Hampton High School for our hockey programming, and that program typically costs us on average $350 in addition to the user fee that we charge our student athletes to participate. That money has already been budgeted for this winter, and so we will be able to contribute that same $350 above and beyond the user fee that we would expect from our student athletes in this particular cooperative agreement. Additionally, we've received an anonymous donation that is on your agenda this evening. That would cover the additional costs of running the program this year. Upon completion of this season, we would assess our involvement and determine whether or not we should continue, both for the organizational reasons but also the financial piece. And then hopefully we would budget that into the 2018 fiscal year to cover the costs of the program, should we believe it's a valuable program to offer our girls.
Does that answer your question? Okay. Any other questions about this?
So we're tonight only, we would be authorizing joining the co-op, but as far as the financial obligation in the future, that would be decided during the next budget season. We're not committing to a long-term
The MIAA, our governing athletic body, will not allow us to enter into a cooperative agreement for more than 1 year because this is a special situation. Generally, cooperative agreements are maybe two or three schools, but they recognize that we're trying to increase participation here, and so they're allowing basically Longmeadow to be the host for Western Mass girls ice hockey. So they have been offering their cooperative agreements on a one-year basis only. So we would likely have to do this again next year. And that the financial implications would be part of that conversation, too.
Yes, Elena, sure.
So you mentioned that the programs at the other cooperatives stop at around age 12. Mm-hmm. And then the high school program would obviously start around like age 14. Mm-hmm. So what is that gap doing, and how are you guys working to increase participation among those kids who are just coming up at age 14? I assume that the ice hockey players are probably upperclassmen or have been at the high school for a little while. So what are you guys doing to make sure that the program is lasting?
So the first piece is that generally the ice hockey, our local youth ice hockey programs will allow student athletes to participate until they're 14. But they sort of label them as K to 12. So they can play right through their eighth grade year, let's say. And depending on their age, some youth hockey programs will allow them to play until they're 14. The second piece around our current participation is actually we have one junior student athlete and one sophomore student athlete. So we don't have any senior females who are interested in this cooperative. So it does allow us the opportunity to grow and hopefully encourage those young ladies to speak to other young ladies who'd like to participate. Ice hockey is a unique sport in that it's very challenging to just pick it up as a ninth grader because there's so much skill and tactical and technical elements to it, but that doesn't mean that students shouldn't come out as a ninth grader and try. With the Longmeadow Cooperative, Longmeadow cannot cut any of their players to displace any of their home athletes to make room for student athletes who are in other schools, but they will add JV games to their schedule so that we can get as many kids playing as possible. I think down the road, having these two young ladies that I know of currently who are interested advocate for the program will help, and then reaching out to the Nonotuc Youth Program to let them know they have another option because they don't, right now, they don't have another option. I think that will change.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yes.
Gate receipts, is there any?
So in a similar way that the East Hampton Co-op works, we receive a bill at the end of the year, and that bill itemizes the expenses and then also the revenues, and then they divide by the number of players, and that's the cost. Over the last 2 years, it's been somewhere around, with the Longmeadow group, it's been somewhere around $1,500 a player.
That's how a comment. I'm certainly all in favor of creating equity for female athletes. But I also hope that maybe long term, where we're investing money, that there'll be some goals set around equality, income equality. Hockey's an expensive sport, which means it precludes participation for lower income kids. Generally speaking, I don't think there's scholarships for kids to play hockey at young ages. Maybe I'm wrong about that. So I'm not opposed to hockey, but I do think when we're investing our money, mm-hmm. I would like to see some goals around making sure that our money is going towards maximum participation, especially across a wide income spectrum. So there are other sports, like you mentioned, there are girls who want a volleyball team. You know, wrestling is a very low cost, easy access sport. So that's just sort of my bigger picture is I wouldn't like to see us turn into a district that only supports sports that require wealthy or, you know, that don't allow opportunity for low income participants.
At the high school level, we offer that opportunity through our waivers, through free and reduced lunch.
Understand.
I can reach out to the youth programs and find out what opportunities they offer for scholarships.
Thanks.
Any other questions or discussions about this? Sure.
I didn't think I'd say the word locker room in here, but I was very moved by that locker room story, that locker room story. And that seems just awful experience for the girls. So I think this is actually a great idea. Thank
you.
Sorry.
NCTV had the delay ready. Just okay. Would you like to make a motion to get this on the table?
Sure. I'd like to make a motion to authorize the cooperative with Long Meadow High School girls hockey team for Northampton High School girls to participate.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that is accepted. And then following along with that, we do have a requested vote to accept an anonymous gift of $2,000 to NHS girls ice hockey.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the gift, the anonymous gift of $2,000 to Northampton High School girls ice hockey.
Second.
Seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. And then we have two other athletic-related gifts. The first is a gift from the boys' soccer boosters, approximately $1,500 for team clothing.
Make a motion to accept the gift for boys' soccer boosters in the amount of approximately $1,500 for team clothing.
Second.
Okay. Did you want to?
As we have transitioned from individual team boosters to the greater or the larger Northampton Athletic Booster Club as our primary fundraising organization, we've asked the individual boosters to decide what they'd like to do with their money and sort of informally or formally, depending on their tax status, dissolve and then sort of join forces with the NABC. The $1,500 is the balance from the Boys Soccer Booster Club, and they are putting it into their gift account for future use.
Okay. Any questions about that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that gift is accepted. Next is a gift from the Boys Soccer Boosters, $1,000. Toward varsity assistant coach.
I make a motion to accept the gift for Boys Soccer Boosters in the amount of $1,000 for the varsity assistant coach.
Second.
I would just like to clarify one point, and that is the person will be working primarily with the freshmen on the varsity team, so it's actually, considered a freshman coach, okay. Not an assistant coach.
So, with that clarification, is there any questions? I know Ms. Fallon, you're contemplating an amendment, or
no. I wanted to ask. So, if the soccer boosters are dissolving, and you're going to use this money to pay for a freshman coach, does that mean that you're only going to have a freshman coach for this 1 year, or that you're going to have to rebudget?
So
I'm not sure how we're replacing boosters paying for coaches.
The assistant, this position is generally a volunteer position, and the person has done it in the past as a volunteer, and the boosters would like to formally recognize the person and hire him as the coach for this year, as opposed to working with him just as a volunteer. So in this particular case, it may be that there won't be funding for it next year, and that's okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that gift is accepted. Next, we have a gift. This is, I guess it's from Crocs. Crocs, the shoe.
That last month.
What's that?
Come on back. One more.
Yes. Crocs, $2,000 to the NHS girls soccer program.
Make a motion to accept the gift of Crocs in the amount of $2,000.
Yeah, I don't think that's what it says.
Right?
Donating $2,000 from Crocs.
That's a lot of Crocs.
The gift is from Crocs, the company.
Is it merchandise, though?
I can explain.
Okay, so maybe I'm not wrong yet. So I'm just going to read it. Crocs, comma, $2,000 to NHS girls soccer.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Okay.
This summer, Crocs was running social media sweepstakes, and it was designed so that each day a person could like one of their Crocs pictures that they posted on Instagram, and that would automatically enter them into this contest. The grand prize was $5,000. To the program, and 20 pairs of Crocs. The first prize was $2,000 and 20 pairs of Crocs, and the third prize was $1,000 and 20 pairs of Crocs. Our girls were really diligent in their liking of the pages, and though I questioned it because I thought they were playing a prank, I talked with the PR person, and she said, yes, in fact, we had won first prize, which is $2,000 to the girls' soccer team, and a pair of Crocs for each one of the varsity players.
It's awesome.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. Any discussions about this? Okay. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Congratulations. And I believe that concludes the gift portion for the athletic
parts
tonight. So thank you. Okay. So now, now we will move into the presentation of school improvement plans. We have presentations from each of our six schools that we'll be hearing tonight. And the first one on deck is Bridge Street Elementary School and Principal Choquette again. And also the aforementioned Miss Busson, mentioned earlier this evening, which I second that, actually. So,
great. Good evening, again. So first I'd like to start with saying my parent, Lori Shine, who is going to present with me tonight, had a previously scheduled engagement, so could not be here. So Jen graciously offered, with a little twist of the arm, to come take her place to help present our school improvement plan. But I do have a letter from Lori Shine to read, if I may. So, dear school committee, it was a privilege to work with Beth Choquette and the other parents, teachers, and community members on the Bridge Street School Council to help shape the school improvement plan for 2016-17. I'm so pleased with the way this plan considers the needs of students everywhere on the spectrum of academic and behavioral capacities, from voracious readers in need of continual challenge to students navigating backgrounds of trauma who are learning that their school can be a safe place. I'm continually amazed by the range of challenges that the faculty and staff meet with grace, professionalism, and aplomb. I look forward to working with the school council this year as we implement parent surveys and bring a parent's point of view to the communications and outreach Bridge Street is undertaking. Strengthening communication will make the school even more accessible and responsive to the families it serves. In our school council meetings, faculty and staff members always took the time to explain acronyms, pedagogical points of view, and the district-wide improvement plan. As a parent member without a background in education, I appreciate this look under the hood at the tools and resources these busy professionals bring to their work. But just as important as the formidable abilities of the teachers and staff, I am profoundly happy to see how wholeheartedly they believe in reaching and supporting every child. The caliber of their commitment is as strong as their professional skills, and both give me great confidence in Bridge Street's present and its future. Sincerely, Lori Shine, parent member of the Bridge Street School Council. So Jen and I will share our goals of this year's plan with you. We're just gonna alternate sharing our school improvement goals. You wanna come up next to me? Okay. So we have this year developed a plan that really targets areas that are important to us as a school, but important to us as a district, and are aligned with our DIP, our district improvement plan. And our first goal for this year builds off of what we call in the district improvement plan the legacy goal of differentiation. We will continue with differentiation, but this year we will have a focus on differentiating up and making sure that we are challenging all students, not just our students who are meeting expectations, but our students who are exceeding the expectations and students who are struggling to meet the expectations. We will do this through our new process that we use around RTI assessments, looking at our data from our RTI assessments, our MCAS data, and other formal and informal assessments that our classroom teachers use to help target and guide their instruction. We are hoping this year, now that we have librarians, which is wonderful, to offer literature circles for our third through fifth graders, to some of our most advanced readers, some time with a librarian and studying novels and other reading at a level that will challenge them is something that we hope we'll be doing, right, Sue? And last year, part of our one of our goals was to really work on rigorous questioning in small group instruction, as well as whole group instruction. So we will continue coaching and working with teachers on those techniques, as well as implementing universal design for learning strategies, which was also a goal last year. This summer, our special ed teachers took part in a book study on UDL, and so we're now going to move into this year with our special ed teachers leading professional learning communities around universal design for learning.
And our second goal is also directly related to the district goals in the superintendent's QSORTs that he's been collecting for the past year. Our goal number two is to increase communication and to receive feedback from all constituencies within our school, the students, the parents, the teachers, regarding our shared core values and a vision for our school. The school council is going to be creating a survey for parents, students, and teachers in order to get feedback regarding our shared core values and our vision for our school. And we will also be developing an exit survey for families that choose to leave the school to find out why they're choosing other school options.
Our third goal is in relation to the DIP goal of effective decision making, and that is to increase communication with our families and to involve them more in our decision making process at Bridge Street. Some ways we'd like to do that this year is, well, this has been kind of ongoing, trying to encourage teachers to have classroom websites and more communication with parents or newsletters. We're really trying to get teachers to come around to the tech piece. For some, it's a challenge because technology can be a scary world, but we're really moving in the right direction, and most of them have some sort of online communication with their families for their classrooms. I would like to take on the current school webpage or create kind of like a principal's blog that is continuously updated on a daily basis. Right now, I send home a weekly newsletter, so I'd like to try to get away from the paper and provide paper for the families that don't have access to the technology, but so I'd like to take that on. And then I'd also like to start what I'm calling right now is kind of monthly chats for community members and families who want to come in, talk about concerns, ask questions, or just to chat. My long-term goal for that is to kind of get out of the school and do it in different areas of the Bridge Street community for our families who may feel intimidated to come into the school and go to various spots in the community to offer these chats. That's one step past the first step of doing the chats.
And our final goal continues from our last year's goal and seems to be kind of our priority school goal, is to develop a comprehensive plan to best meet the needs of our students who struggle socially, emotionally, and behaviorally. Our school social emotional behavioral team will meet to design a three-tiered system for offering support to our struggling students, and we are fully implementing the second step curriculum at Bridge Street all at the same time in the morning, including over the announcements to the entire schools. We're all kind of hearing the same thing and working on the same skills at the same time. And we will have a school-wide use of the zones of regulation with all of our students, and we continue to use PBIS.
Okay. And that's our plan.
Thank you. Do members of the school committee have comments or questions about the Bridge Street School Improvement Plan?
I have some general comments, and not necessarily just limited to Bridge, but since you're first, I'll share some. I really love sort of the theme throughout many of them, and including yours, in the engaging families in the decision-making process, including the construction of the SIP. I really liked the theory of action language, that if we do this, then this is what the outcome should be. And then just as maybe a suggestion or a comment, in terms of communication with parents, push versus pull. So if I have to remember to go to a website and, you know, read a blog entry versus being able to sign up and it just comes to me in an email, mm-hmm. or it comes to me on a text message to link to the site, that just you'd have more people reading it.
Great. Yes, Ms. Pisaski.
I just wanted to add that I really, I love that idea of having an exit survey. I think that's a real missing piece, and I think that's a really great kind of creative idea to really find out why our family is leaving, and so we can try and understand more about how we can improve and meet the needs of our family. So, thanks.
I'm just going to pile on the love. I think I agree with what the other two members have said, and the outreach to the community, I think it's just such a great thing, to sort of breaking down the walls and making people feel included. And this idea of going and meeting people, especially in other places, is such a great thing. So, thanks.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you,
Principal Chiquette. Thank you, Ms. Busson. Next, we will hear from Jackson Street Elementary School. I was going to say, okay. So,
no, I'm Mark Moosier. I'm a parent also at Jackson Street School.
Excellent.
Representing.
Excellent. And
I have some words from
Jenny. Yeah, Jenny sends her words through Mark.
Okay, excellent.
All right. So, dear school committee, I regret not being able to present Jackson Street School's 2016-2017 school improvement plan. As I'm especially proud of recent work emerging from our own school committee, school council meetings. I also regret that Gwen must present the SIP on her own. I'm here. So doing so is not an accurate reflection of the incredibly collaborative nature of our school council and of the creation of the SIP. It is truly an honor to sit around a table each month, I agree with that, with such a committed and reflective group of faculty, staff, and parents, where we sometimes challenge and always listen to and learn from one another, and where Gwen always participates as another member with an equal, not a stronger, nor more important voice. Beginning in the spring of 2016 and continuing into this new school year, we have used many of our council meetings to talk about and plan for ways to clarify and honor our core values. Some of these conversations have grown out of the inspiring work John Provost is doing at the district level to identify shared values. Some have grown out of growing discomfort many of us feel as we find ourselves straying from what we think of as our school's core values. Jackson Street is one of the few communities of which I've been a part of that does not simply give lip service to honoring diversity, but actually makes it a daily priority to include all members of the community. As most of us know, this is no easy feat. It requires constant vigilance. It requires an ongoing commitment to self-reflection and community dialogue, and to reevaluating and remaking community routines and habits. We therefore prioritized in this year's SIP a commitment to values-based decision-making. As I read above, drafting the JSS School Improvement Plan has been a truly collaborative process. We used time in some of our school council meetings to draft and revise parts of the Jackson Street School Improvement Plan. Gwen then created a Google Doc, which she emailed to council members, and many of us responded with questions, suggestions, and edits, both big and small. We only finalized the draft when no one had any more feedback. I think of all of us on the Jackson Street School Council are proud of the work we've done and continue to do, not just in creating the school improvement plan, but in nurturing a community that engages in all the practices outlined in the school improvement plan and engaging with one another in ways that yield constant growth. Sincerely, Jenny Bender, co-chair of Jackson Street School Council.
Thanks, Mark.
Cool.
Thank you, Jenny.
Yeah, she's great.
So I know that you have our school improvement plan, so I will just do some highlighting of it. I began with a quote that I thought was really important, especially in this political environment as well as our own looking at our values, from Martin Luther King, that says, "A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily on the glaring contrast of poverty and wealth." It's a constant challenge that we face. So we'll continue some of the goals and activities that we had from our school improvement plan last year. And I listed those, but I did want to highlight that we will be writing more units from our school garden project and putting them on Rubicon Atlas so we can establish this work as the core of our life sciences. I also want to acknowledge that there are many teachers at our school very interested in getting going on the new generation science standards, and we know we have a lot of initiatives in our school community, but we also want to try to get onto those as well. So two teachers will be going to professional development at CES on NGSS, and also we will form a science committee at our school to begin transforming our science education practices. I think those are pretty, the rest are obvious in terms of what we're going to continue to do. We changed the wording. It wasn't if we do. I know that you like that, Tom. we all agreed that we wanted to say we will continue to develop and successfully implement a comprehensive plan. And we will base it on our district improvement plan, the goals as outlined by our district improvement plan, which begin with the value-oriented decision-making, as in QSORT. As Jenny pointed out, we're very excited about the stakeholder conversation that has happened through the QSORT, which really parallels a lot of the work that we do at our school, trying to come up with ways to make sure all stakeholders' voices are represented at our school. We wanted to begin by looking again at our family survey, which we did last spring, and develop a mission and vision statement collaboratively, and also look at ways that we can include the decision making that happens, sometimes it seems behind the scenes in our school, through putting explanations of that in our newsletter, in our coffee hours, family dinners, council meetings, PTO, all the ways that we make decisions around class assignments, extending and enriching learning, holiday traditions, how we celebrate them, all of those things that I think myself, as this is my 21st school improvement plan that I'm giving, you know, some things you think, oh, they know that. But of course, we know that there's turnover every few years in schools, even if there isn't in the administration. So we want to also enhance and diversify our family and school relationships. I just presented this in a 5-minute summary to our PTO tonight, because our PTO has been wanting to join with our school council in looking at ways that we can be more inclusive in our school. We have had ebbs and flows of that inclusivity, depending on mainly people who have been interested in stepping up and trying to join in. But we really want to do more concentrated and intentional outreach to families who don't really typically like to come to meetings, but might like to do other kinds of activities. The QSORT will help us in these conversations with our stakeholders, and hopefully we can help align our school values. In goal, well, it's goal 8 in the DIP, but the effective decision-making process, which is reflective practice and action research. We began our work last spring with Andrea Vazian and anti-bias education. And again, that's one of those things that I think people sort of sit on their laurels, or might even say we're post-racist society or racial society, and we're not, of course. And so we had a good session with her, with a workshop that included ESPs and faculty and clerical, and thinking about ourselves as practitioners and making sure that we are really doing what we say we're doing, that we're talking the talk and walking the walk.
We're also going to be looking at our mindfulness project again, which we've been doing for many years, and try to put some action research to it to see whether we can measure some of the effects that are happening in our school. And the last goal being differentiating up, I did include the definition that we kind of put together and that was in the district, what's it called again?
Improvement Insider.
Improvement Insider. Because I think at our council and in our faculty meeting, we discussed what is different about differentiating up from differentiation. It's a conversation that we'll continue to have. And I think what we really felt at Jackson Street in our council and in our faculty that we really wanted to continue to work intentionally to raise the floor for all students and continue to teach with fidelity to the curriculum standards and the programs and materials that we have in the district so that it does continue our obligation to students to differentiate at all levels, for sure. We're happy that we're going to begin work with Emily Hodos and Janice Toddy, who's our PE teacher, with a grant on neurofitness or brain gym, which is an extension of our mindfulness, but it really is looking at making our bodies and minds more available to learning. We're going to be doing that through faculty meetings as well as coaching in the classrooms. We are going to put our minds to viewing the new teachers workshop model that has come to us. It's new work to be implemented, and we'll be continuing to hone our skills in that. And we will continue to develop teaching and learning strategies to increase the success of our students who are ELLs in a somewhat challenging situation where we have many, and I think our resources are limited, and those who are in the low-income bracket. Some of you know that we've had a bumper sticker at our school for many, many years. It was a parent about 1999 who heard an article on NPR about the sort of the Alfie Cohn kind of punished by rewards idea that there are bumper stickers everywhere in this country that say my student is an honor student at so-and-so middle school, or you know, my student is better than your student, or my dog is better than your dog. And she put that together into a bumper sticker that we have that is every student at Jackson Street is an honored student. I'm recommitting to that promise because I'm not sure we always live up to that. And I think that it's really important to us that we reflect and put our minds to kind of retooling and recommitting to all students at Jackson Street School. And I'm hoping that with this school improvement plan, we can do that.
Excellent, thank you. Questions or comments for Principal Agna?
Sort of a comment about this, but also generally, I mean, I think the superintendent's done a really great job this year of asking all the schools to really embrace the school improvement process because it is a way of bringing the community in and finding out what the community wants its schools to be doing and growing. And we're asking our teachers and our students to have a growth mindset. So we need our buildings to have a growth mindset as well. And so I would recommend to everybody that they look into the research of Carol Dweck, who you probably know from Persistence and Grit and all that kind of thing. Some of her early work was in goal setting. And for some people, goal setting has a sort of a dirty ring to it because they've been in the corporate setting where it's sort of arbitrary and bizarre. But there's actually a lot of research about how effective it can be if it's done right in moving people and organizations. So one of the things that I would recommend going forward is that there be really, first of all, you identify what the things are that need to be improved at the school based on what you're hearing from staff and community, and then figure out solutions that are sort of stretch goals. So we want, and then those goals have to be measurable. So we want to raise our number of ELL students who are doing this by this amount by this time so that a year later we can look at those goals and say, yes, those have been met, that's great, let's duplicate that methodology in other schools, or gee, that didn't work, so we didn't achieve that goal, so let's try something different. So if I just hope that going forward, we'll all strive to kind of look into the goal setting research and try to set stretch goals and then try to break them down into steps that are measurable and actionable. So let's.
Okay. Any other comments or questions?
I just have a comment in regards to what I just heard Mr. Reed say. In regards to just what we're expected by the state and what we do, I think at each of our schools with the AYP, and I think, you know, with the annual yearly progress, I think that's probably part of what we do on a yearly basis as educators and administrators. Would that be accurate to say?
It's one of the measures for sure. Yeah, definitely.
I love this. I think it's great. Mr. Reed reminded me of Carol Dweck's work, which I found out because of the work that you guys do at your school. And my kids talk about growth mindset. But I love this, and I think that we have so much stuff that's measurable and about numbers that I actually love how you've written this, and I love the collaborative work you guys have been doing, so thank you.
Thanks. I was just thinking that any Jackson Street people watching will say, we do, Carol Dweck. Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Thank you both.
I just also say to who's watching that we will have this on our website so that it wasn't read tonight, and it will be there if people want to read it. And I think all of our school improvement plans will be on the website.
Excellent. Great.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, next we have Principal Cannata and Hannah. Okay, good. Just we've had so many fill-ins tonight. I don't want to introduce somebody incorrectly. So we have Hannah Durant West, who's a parent on the school council.
Correct. I'm going to apologize now. I didn't prepare any formal remarks. I am a parent on the school council.
Chair.
I have four children at Leeds School who love it. And actually, my first year was Sal's first year at Leeds, so we put that together. So the school council at Leeds was pretty small when I kind of poked my head in the room. And I would say over the last 2 years, we've grown from four people attending sporadic meetings to about 20 people attending meetings every month. And a really involved parents really wanting to get involved and engaged in the community in different ways. One of the things Sal has really worked on is community engagement and parent engagement. And I think his efforts into the school council, but also into the larger community, has really shown over the last 3 years. And I think you can show up to any school picnic or really any event where families are invited and we're just busting at the gills, which is really a reflection of what Sal has been working on. And so as a school council, we wanted to continue that work. And so last year, we did our first school climate committee to try to figure out where we go. So Leeds is already doing some really great things and has a pretty good school community, but how do we continue to strive to do better and to be serving our students and our community better? And so we did our first climate survey, which revealed some really interesting things and was intriguing for me as I looked over the data. And that we'll talk about that more in our school improvement plan. But from that, the school council has really identified kind of five working areas that we want to work on, and that's around curriculum and kind of supporting how we talk about curriculum to our families, but also how do we engage with you all as a school committee about what curriculum is chosen for our schools. Social justice, that was something that really came through in our climate survey, was a need to talk about it more, a need to educate our students and our families, and also how to create an inclusive school community so that we are not only reflective of all of our community members, but how are we talking about the hard topics and the difficult conversations that are going on, and especially as we are in today's day and age, how important that is to be able to prepare our children to be able to talk about that. Communication and community engagement, that was something that came out of that climate survey and something that Sal has been working on, and so we started a class representative program. And so that's where each class will have a parent representative and kind of pulls the class together, also the grade level. And that's really gotten many more families engaged at the class level, but also at the larger school level. And then we feel like there's a strong need to work collaboratively with our PTO and to just continue building on what the good things we have going on in the community. So we have a kind of a community PTO group as well. And then we will continue doing our climate survey every other year. So we'll do it 1 year, use that data to influence kind of and work on the next year, and then the following year we'll do another climate survey. So as I said, I'm really excited about what's happening, and I think as we talk about our school improvement plan, you'll hear how kind of the work that we're doing is influencing kind of Sal's vision of the school.
All right. Well, thanks, Hannah. Yeah. So I'm pleased to be here before you guys all tonight. It's always a pleasure to come back. It's not always hard, easy to follow Gwen. But I...
he talks about it a lot.
Yeah. I don't know about 21 years. But I'm pleased to be here with Hannah, Hannah, who is a mother of four in the building, and great to have around. The school, we struggled as a school council last few years, particularly when I first got there. There was three or four people in the room, and now it's expanded. And I think that's a direct reflection on the type of community we are trying to create at Leeds. And my philosophy for, and I think what's become a community philosophy, is if we provide a place that, if we create an atmosphere that allows for solid teaching and solid learning, in a place where kids feel safe and comfortable, I think the learning can happen. I think that's the real goal at elementary school at Leeds right now. And you walk in and it feels like a great learning environment. I think kids are safe and happy there. And I keep saying the grades are going to come and the learning is going to come, and it has. So, like my colleagues here, we've all worked with our school councils to create a plan that's aligned with the district goals. And it's adaptable and realistic and within the framework of the elementary school. I am lucky, like Hannah said, to have a supportive, understanding, engaged group of people on the school council who work with me to create the plan. So I'm going to preface my remarks by saying that the three goals that were previously in the school improvement plan, the RTI, the creating a unified mindset, and then using data systems, they're still there. And because they're still alive, and they're still well, and they're still developing. So it didn't make sense to me to put those aside and work on three new ones, but rather I chose to try to embed this year's goals within the three existing goals. Then we added one. So we're still working on RTI, we're still working on data, we're always working on communication, and I think Hannah would agree, we pride ourselves on the amount of community involvement and the communication that we try to put out there. So this year's goals of, you know, values, effective decision making, and differentiating up are all embedded, as I said before. So I mean, I gave you that second copy, and the reason I did that is because I bolded those things that were obvious, the changes, because I think, again, it looked very similar. So the first bold lies within goal two, where the DIP plan work for 17-18 includes effective decision-making processes through action research. You heard Hannah say that we're doing our climate survey. So it was really neat for me to be at ALT this summer, and we started talking about our action research and what we're going to do, because I feel our climate survey that went out really allowed us a framework and a map to work towards this year. That survey allowed us to do simple things that, you know, maybe from getting different perspectives, things simple like switching recess and lunch times, you know, from having recess first instead of recess last, you know, things like that. Or trying different ways to expand our after-school enrichment. And then, of course, differentiating up, but that came through in our parent surveys as more challenging work for those who were capable. So it was nice that there was a tie-in. And again, that's coincidentally, that's aligned with the legacy goal of differentiating up, and that's goal four, which is bolded. The second bolded item are, again, embedded within the objectives and the goal, and again, the school climate survey. It provided the school council an opportunity to form committees to complete action research and thus, I think, make effective decisions. So Hannah mentioned, we have four elected people or five?
Five.
We have five elected people, but we have 20 plus who attend, and as a result, we have subcommittees working within school council, each member of the school council heading up a subcommittee. So we have these working groups that hopefully allow us to make some effective decision making. The third bolded item The QSORT falls within that values clarification. My school council's completed it. My PTO has completed it. Dr. Provost came up for a couple events last year. We've had parent involvement on doing that. And my fifth grade has recently completed the QSORT as well. So getting, a really large amount of information back from the Leeds community. And like I already mentioned, goal four is all about differentiating up, or differentiation, however you want to call it. And there's three distinct objectives which support this goal, which I can say with confidence have been driving instruction since the RTI initiative began. So within that goal, just different things. And if you think about differentiating up, how are we going to take this student who's reading at a BAS level H, how are we going to get him to a J or K? But there's other ways to use a differentiating up. And what we did with some of the enrollment that went down at our lower grades this year, we were able to open up two slots in the arts. And for the first time, we have kids who have an option to take chorus at fifth grade, which I think is awesome, you know, and allowing the kids a creative outlet. Our art teacher has done some more sophisticated art with kids because her block, we have a little flexibility in there. So we have that going on. We have some bucket drumming happening in music, which is really amazing, too, to watch. But on the academic level, of course, our data teams and our ILT, we found after digging deep into the data that it was time to really start revisiting open response questions again. Leeds, as you probably know, has gone up 18% in 3 years on our MCAS, or our, what's the acronym I'm looking for? Not AYP. Our level has gone from a 3 to 2, and we're up, we've gone up 18 percentage points. But now we're noticing that we still need to work on open response, so that's where the data team is working with the grade level teachers on for open response. But I thought I'd share, it's not in here, but just an idea of another example of differentiating up that is happening. The teachers get a instructional supply budget. We work with an instructional supply budget, and we knew that the goal is differentiating up. So I had a teacher who headed up a small little committee that did research on what, because we couldn't find differentiating up, but rather on talented and gifted, and found through William and Mary College and then through the University of Virginia some different groups, different resources, different books to challenge kids who are already here. You know, what can we do differently? So we found a series of books, language arts based, based on the Common Core, that we're able to use our RTI pre-assessment work, use our new resources, so those kids who are already here have an opportunity to get even higher. So it's really neat to watch. It's just one example. It's not in the plan, but it's something that I see happening all over the building. That's just one example, and of course there's stations and there's rotations going on in classes and there's learning stations, and just great to watch. So I didn't read directly from the plan. I didn't feel I had to, and I'm sure you've all read it as well. But again, collaborative process, collaborative group of people, and it's my pleasure to present it to you.
Thank you, Mr. Cannata. Any questions or comments about the Leeds School Improvement Plan? Mr. Reed.
I just want to say this, to me, is ideal. You know, you've surveyed your community, you listened to a wide range of people, you set goals based on what you saw your needs from, you know, where you needed improvement, then you broke it down into actionable steps that are measurable. So I'm not talking about, you know, mathematical, numerical, test score kinds of measurements. I'm just talking about you know, we'll meet twice monthly with the principal. Well, you know, at the end of the year, you can look back on that and say we did that or we didn't do that. So this, I think, is really a great job all around.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions for Mr. Cannata?
Can I just say one
sure.
more thing? And So I think everybody knows we had a great loss at Leeds School with the passing of Ms. Wood. And I just want to thank the support from the top down to allow the community to go and honor Ms. Wood in such a wonderful way. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, next up is Principal Madden and Ryan Road School. And I believe she has Mary Curtin.
Yes,
with her.
I am still Mary Curtin.
Excellent. Good. just checking. So, floor is yours.
Okay, great. Well, you know, we thought we were going to be really original today, coming to talk about surveying our community, communication, but now when you go last, you realize you're not that original. Similar to other schools, a big focus for us last year was increasing our communication with our parent and family community. Ryan Road, if you've been in the school, is a wonderful embodiment of a responsive classroom. When you walk in, you're known, you feel valued, you're greeted, and there's just kind of warm fuzzies all around. But what that means for me as a parent who's on the school council is I'm not getting a ton of feedback coming around what's going on that's working well or what's going on that's not working well. A lot of it is just general, yeah, things are great. And so we really wanted to get more information to help us design our school improvement plan. So last year, in talking with other schools that had done surveys in the past, and even one school was nice enough to loan us their survey, Molly, and we designed a survey that we were able to give to the parent community. We did it electronically, we did it on paper, we did it in multiple languages. We hosted a night where everyone came and there were events and people could fill it out in multiple ways. And we got a lot of good information, and one of the big areas that came out in the survey is, in a lot of areas, people felt like we were doing a pretty good job, and we were happy about that. But in one area in particular, the scores were not as great, and that area was for students that were functioning at grade level or above. The parent and family community said pretty clearly, we're not doing as well in this area. So that became for us a big focus of the school improvement plan for this year. I think overall we got close to about 40% participation in the survey, which was we were happy about. So I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Madden to talk about what our plan is.
Great, thank you. I'd just like to read our overarching hope, which is really what we operate under, is our overarching hope is that Ryan Road School is a place where children laugh and enjoy learning, where they want to come to school, where they are continually gaining skills, character, and confidence, and where they feel supported by a strong and caring learning community. And that is something that I try to read frequently because it's just really sort of does encompass what we try to do. And laughter is a big part of our school, so I try to keep that going because it helps in all sorts of circumstances. So anyway, I just wanted to talk about our goals. One was differentiated instruction, and I do think that it was a carryover certainly from last year, and I don't think you're ever done with differentiated instruction. I taught for 23 years before I was principal, and it's the most important and the most difficult work that teachers do, and so you're never done figuring out ways to do that. But I think our universal screenings are sort of helping with targeting our needs. We are hoping to do walkthroughs this year that all teachers can participate in that will focus on differentiation so that our teachers are figuring out what other people are doing and trying to have conversations around that topic as they get a chance to observe in other rooms. And I think that will be a really important part of what we're doing. And we're also using our social and emotional data to support our behavioral and emotional needs a little bit more specifically. And that's, I think, a needed area. And so that's been our good start already in that regard. Our goals do mirror the district goals. We're clarifying educational values by participating in the QSOAR. We are also our student leadership team, which is a group of very enthusiastic third, fourth, and fifth graders that I can hardly keep up with, are going to survey students, which I think will be really interesting. And so some of those questions will be similar to the parent questions in some regards, but then there are certainly many that are not at all similar that are interesting that the students are coming up with. So that should be a fun gathering of information as we clarify our values at Ryan Road. And sort of developing better ways to make decisions. We are thinking about action research. My sort of current, not as measurable as it could be, action research is that I'm trying to look at how we can use more explicit, consistent, coordinated sort of visual communication around school-wide behavior expectations and whether or not clarifying that as a school is going to sort of lower office referrals and behavioral. So we're going to see. We're working on it, and we're moving in a good direction. So that's good. Any questions? I know you have the plan, and it will be online.
Any yes?
I just really wanted to say I love that there's so many pieces as a former teacher that we are never done learning. And society is always changing, and it's always growing. And when you bring up never done learning differentiation, I just hope that, you know, we as a school committee and we as a Northampton community and you as teachers and the ALT team really recognize that we are continually learning. Everything is changing all the time, and we really appreciate that. I think approaching all of this stuff from that place is such a wonderful place to be, and I really honor that a lot.
Ms. Fallon.
I'm so impressed with all four elementary schools, how ambitious their plans are, and I just wanted to say I do appreciate, you know, the very scientific-based approach, but what you did with the, it's a non-scientific, like, we're going to try it. Yeah. I think there's a really good place for that, especially in elementary school, for kids to see, we're going to try it, we'll see what happens. It's almost like, you know, that's what you're asking them to do, to take risks in learning and see what they should do and how they can adjust. So I do appreciate that at least one of your things is like, let's give it a go. We'll see if it works.
I do that a lot in a day. Let's give it a go.
Dr. Baird.
So at the risk of talking about Ryan Road.
I always like it when you talk about Ryan
Road. It was really great at Open House to see the survey results. And you were very happy to point me to them and make sure I saw them. And you have to be somewhat brave to do that and to do it with kids now, too, because you don't know what the results are going to be, but it can be such a powerful exercise. So I thank you for that. All the elementary schools talked about differentiating up, and I know it's in the JFK plan as well. I would be really curious to have some continuing conversations about that. We had talked about it at the curriculum subcommittee, looking at the math program, the idea of differentiating up and resources for math and what could students do to go beyond what particular, maybe what the grade level expectations were. And so I think that, you know, we talked about coming back to that idea at the next curriculum subcommittee meeting, so I'm excited to talk about that some more. But I'm also really interested in, like, what's the long term? You know, what does differentiating up look like? And, you know, Sal brought up the idea of, you know, gifted and talented and looking at that research, and part of that is accelerated learning. So how does that all fit into this? So anyway, I'm interested to continue that.
Any other comments or questions? Thank you both very much. Oh, I'm sorry, Nat.
That's okay. I just also wanted to thank you. This is great. And mention something that I'd heard, which I think is a huge credit to your building, which is that every other school council meeting, you work on the SIP. So this is a year-long process, and I just think that's so great, and that's why this is a great document, that you're really committed to this as a process for growth, and I thank you for that.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, next we have Principal Wilson and Melissa Phelan from JFK Middle School. Well, thank you for being you. That hasn't happened.
She's really here.
Consistently.
I'm really here. And as well, I didn't realize I could do an essay in absentia of being here this evening. But it's nice to be here with y'all. Thank you. This is my second year on the school council at JFK. I also have a middle schooler there, so I'm thrilled to be part of that. Being part of the second year of the council, it's also the second year that we're working towards this plan. So when we share with you the plan, it's some modifications and enhancements of the prior year plan. In our hopes, what we did is, as a group, to try to enhance those to ensure that, as Mr. Reed mentioned, that our goals are smart, they're specific, they're measurable, they're attainable, they're time-bound, and helping us get that way. So as a school council, what we have been prided with is taking a look at all of these areas of action and helping support those, whether it's through the day of service, helping out with writing grants, and so on and so forth. So I hope that you'll see what we're working on and how we can support it.
Thanks. All right. So I just wanted to start by saying thank you for all of your support and dedication to our school community and all of our schools. We really, really appreciate it. And I also wanted to mention that our school council is really an exceptional group, and I feel like we are really growing in the work that we're doing, and it's a collaborative process, and our school council is really committed to the success of our students and supporting the work that we do as a school community. And I want to thank the school council for helping us develop our plan. And we were a small group for a while, and we've now grown to 16 members, and I think it's exciting, and we've got some really great teachers, community members, and parents and guardians helping us improve what we do at our school. So we really appreciate that. Our plan, as Melissa said, is a two-year plan, so this will reflect our tremendous progress and next steps. We're going to highlight the changes in the plan. We know you have it, and it will be on our website. Again, just to mention that it is aligned with the district improvement plan as well. So to begin with, our first theory of action focuses on restorative practice. And this is something I think the superintendent shared some information with you about, the results of some of the work that we're doing or that we began last year with the restorative practice model. And so our goals have changed because of the progress that we've made in the restorative practice implementation in our school. And so goal one now will be, we are going to attempt to do more training with the Just Schools project, which we did before, and we're hoping to train at least 20 additional teachers and administrators. Last year we did 20 teachers and in the in-depth training, and we also did all ESPs and all teachers with the general training. So this year our goal is for 20. We have 21 new teachers, ESPs, and administrators in the building. So not only are we going to do some formal training, but we're doing lots of informal training with the group that actually became the leadership group last year. And goal two, we're going to continue to strengthen our model, emphasizing the restorative language and response. And we're going to measure that by monitoring our kind of repair practices to our disciplinary consequence ratio, and that's how that will be measurable. I think we really want to build on our successes and engage students in the practice. So bringing this more to the student level, we are piloting classroom circles. There's a group that is very committed to restorative practice in our building. They'll have monthly meetings, and they're going to pilot some classroom circles to involve students more in the discussion and taking more responsibility for the culture in our school. Students are actually starting to speak the language, and we had some students already this year ask us if they could do a repair, and it was really great, and they made suggestions for what the repair could be. They understood that there potentially could be some consequence for their actions, but they wanted to do a repair as a result of what they did. So I think we're really making big progress with the restorative practice model at our school.
And our second theory of action involves engaging caregivers and community stakeholders and the academic and social group of all students, which remains the same from last year. However, what we have done is we have taken a look at goal number one, which relates to the outreach and communication with parents, and enhance that by adding in a school council survey of parents and guardians, which is currently under the development, and using some of those information surveys from the elementary schools that were mentioned previously, and looking at an approved JFK website, and again, to having some push instead of just some pull out there on that. And the second goal as part of that one is to further develop more meaningful student connections, focusing through the community service and civic engagement. I spoke in my introduction about the day of service that we had a very big success with last year, and working on that again this year, and as a council helping with possibly the new NEF grant to get funding for that as well, and looking for different ways. And then also increasing number of JFK community partnerships, and that was really an outreach of that as well. And the, just
to add that the day of service actually came out of conversations we had at school council about our students and the community and trying to make connections with our students in the community. And so the school council wrote the NEF grant, and that's how the day of service was established. It was really an idea that grew from our council 2 years ago. So, our third theory of action is about identifying, analyzing, and using relevant data to inform instruction. The piece of this that has changed is we changed the last line of that to say accelerate academic growth school-wide. Prior to that, we were really focused on subgroups of students, and we've changed that language. For our goal, one has changed, and it is now that teachers will utilize formative and summative assessments to make data-driven decisions for implementing rigorous lessons with a focus on differentiation up. So again, we are aligned with the work that we're doing district-wide on differentiating up. We're using local and state data and assessment, and a lot of pre and post progress monitoring, and really trying to identify where students are, meet them where they are, and move them forward from there. Our second goal is about JFK staff collaboratively engaging in data-driven decision-making to implement school-wide practices that best serve all students increase overall achievements. And we're using data for many reasons. We're doing surveys, we're using our SDQ, just a deeper use of data and using it in more diverse ways.
To kind of piggyback on that takes us to our last theory of action, number four, and an increased access to technology and training for folks. And enhancing that with goal number one, offering high quality training, instruction, and support for teachers and students focused on assistive technology for all learners. And utilizing that assistive technology, sometimes we think about it as, you know, for the hearing impaired or visually impaired or something like that, but taking it to the next level and making sure that things that that may not be apparent to everyone at all times, using that assistive technology in creative ways so it's just not out of the box and people know what to use it for. And the other ones are the same.
Great.
Okay. Dr. Baird.
So the restorative practices, just some follow-up questions. Is this year two of that initiative?
It is.
So my understanding is that it can be a fairly labor-intensive in terms of professional development and time-consuming in the moment when you're working with students. But the long-term benefit outweighs that investment. So what are you seeing, a decrease in office referrals or a change in language with kids?
We are. So I know that the superintendent shared some of our data at the school committee meeting, I think it was in July, but our suspension rate was down 80%. Our suspension rate for last year was down 80% from the year prior, and the number of days students were suspended was down 75% from the year prior. So we are really seeing different interventions, different conversations with students, different approaches by faculty and staff and administration and students around how to repair any harm or how to resolve problems differently. So we're seeing a lot.
So I'm not so much, I'm kind of wanting a vertical alignment. So I would think that from responsive classroom to restorative would be like a pretty natural shift. But what happens now at the high school? Are we going to continue looking at restorative practices for the high school?
I guess that would be a question. A lot of the things that we do, we align vertically, and we have those conversations, with teachers and guidance counselors. And so we do a lot of data sharing. We do a lot of work within the transition for students from eighth to, the high school. And so I would imagine that, we certainly will be talking about this and sharing what we're learning and talking to Brian and especially the guidance counselors at the high school. Yep.
Other questions or comments about the JFK plan? Thank you both very much for presenting. And finally, we have the Northampton High School School Improvement Plan, and Principal Lombardi is here, and I see that Jeremy Whalen will be part of the presentation.
Yes. So first of all, thank you for having us. It's an honor always to speak in front of you, and especially an honor to talk about the work we do at the school council and representing Northampton High School. I have two letters to read from you of two parents that could not be here, as well as Mr. Whalen, a new member to the school council. So maybe I'll start off with Mr. Whalen, who might want to say a few words.
Yeah, I'll try to make it brief, having sat through some of those. and again, everything that we're doing, I think that really gets lost is everything that we're doing is great. Everything that we're doing is improving our school system, our districts, our schools. And as a teacher, I can give you the teacher's perspective. And what we often see is absolutely great initiatives, and there's In part of the translation of these initiatives, what you see is the pedagogical terms being used, being these real big six-syllable words that can, if not done and implemented properly, become lost in translation. And so as a teacher, as the medium between the facilitator of that education of the student and of the and having in understanding and subscribing to these things, what I can say is all of the things that we are doing are truly improving the lives of our students. So when you think about, I'm getting my master's in ed right now, the amount of terminology that comes by you, you have to go and Google things because there's so many things. But the understanding that we have from professional development, the understanding and implementation of these things is really and truly, I'm a meat and potatoes kind of guy. Get down to brass tacks. How's it going to help my students? How do we do this efficiently and as a unified front? And I see I'm new to the student improvement plan, but that's not to say that I don't see all of these things being implemented already. So a couple of things that really stick out to me. It's kind of just a little bullet point here. Faculty meetings and interdisciplinary groups. You have no idea what that means to teachers to be able to sit down with other. Before, it was kind of this natural progression of you go to your department and you sit there and you talk about the things that you talk about every day. But when you sit, it was something that it was just totally. Didn't even think about it until we had a couple of meetings where I got to sit and talk with a physics teacher, talk to a history teacher, think about ways that we could collaborate. In that 5 minutes before we even start, there's a lot of great ideas flowing at the table, and then it feeds into our meetings. The other thing that I really appreciate about this, and I really hope that we see a great implementation of this, is the mentor program. Students are abuzz about this. I had one student that came in to my room, and he said, "Do you have any information about this?" I was like, "Oh yeah. Well, it's forming everything. What are you looking to do?" He said, "I'm from Puerto Rico, and you know, I see some of the students struggling with English. So I, you know, as I'm helping them out in getting the gist of what's going on in our school, I can also help them out with their Spanish skills." And having been part of the awesome summer program that we put on at this school, there's nothing better, and there's nothing those students want more than to have a friend, to have somebody they feel comfortable with, and to open up and engage for that. So again, it's kind of what I really appreciate is your eyes kind of gloss over sometimes when you're sitting there and you get all these things, but when you cut to the chase, you see what's on this list. I'm proud to be a part of all of these things, and I do think that it's an improvement to our school.
Thank you. I believe you have copies of the parent letters. Should I read that? Should I read them for the record?
I think we can, if we have copies of them, they can be included in the record.
Okay.
Yeah.
So read them.
I think members have them and have.
Okay, great. So I think it explains that it has been a collaborative process. It has been a discussion. One of the things I can say is that I've had opportunities to be involved in many school councils, and what was refreshing about this makeup of the teachers and the parents was really a group of individuals coming together, setting aside maybe personal agendas of their own personal experiences as being a parent or a teacher, and really being able to take a look at the school as a whole to bring things forth to benefit all students. And I think what you have here is a school improvement plan. This is year two. Was a plan that was really designed to try to raise the education and the success for all students. And so what I have here is our goals are the same, but but the initiatives of those goals, what are you going to see the differences? So I'll show you the initiatives. So for the first goal, develop a data system to better understand student population course offerings and selection and effective decision making. This year, we've moved to a tiered model of course offerings and instructional support. Through action research, we will assess the impact of this new model with review of student credit accumulation, class promotion, and class attendance. Second initiative, we'll have our data team to review MCAS data, review for trends or patterns, and assist with identification for key areas of targeted interventions and growth, along with a team of administrators and teachers to attend a two-day workshop, closing the achievement gaps and raising achievement for all students to learn strategies to develop a specific action plan for NHS. As you also heard from Mr. Whalen, a mentor program to support identified students transition to Northampton High School. This would entail a grant through the PTO and NEF for a consultant to assist in program development and training. Mentor training is set up for semester one and hopefully implementation for semester two. Our initiatives for the second goal, develop a universal growth mindset that all students will take advantage of the academic opportunities, differentiated instruction in Northampton High School's academic and social and civic learning expectations in order to achieve a level of success we want for all students. Initiative, cultivate a unified mindset. A team of teachers and administrator attended one session of a two-session workshop, Leading Together, Building Adult Communities in Schools. To utilize faculty meetings and establish a collaborative culture through opportunities in interdisciplinary groups, as Mr. Whalen mentioned. We'll continue to work on curriculum writing. Embedded in our curriculum writing is the continued work on DI and DI up, so that is always embedded in that. We'll be using our faculty meeting, having workshops. We've already designed the workshops with my associate principal, Lori Valancourt, and Nancy Cheevers all the way through April, very specific workshops for the UBD model to have workshops about assisting teachers in their curriculum writing. Departments have department PD maps and utilization of department meetings and release time and PD days to complete or make progress on curriculum writing. Finalize design and implementation plan for PE requirement for class of 2020. We will hope to have our sophomore opportunities in our program of studies for the 2017-2018 school year. And Lens 21, each department will have a minimum of three values embedded in each department philosophy, with a philosophy statement of how the values will be integrated in the curriculums as well as the specific courses. And that's our initiatives for our plan. Questions, thoughts?
Questions, comments from any of the school committee members? Okay.
I have a totally frivolous question.
Frivolous questions, okay.
This teacher of yours, Jeremy Whalen, so he teaches full time, he's getting a master's degree, he's on the school council, he's on the board of NCTV, and he's the advisor of what, five different clubs at the high school?
That's just
amazing example of our amazing faculty.
Absolutely. He's a very positive energy, and I guess he's a great representative and brings a lot to the school as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you for recognizing that.
Yeah.
Ms. Fallon?
I just love the emphasis on collaboration, interdisciplinary, in between schools, vertical alignment between the school councils and PTOs and the NEF. Like, I just feel like we have so many amazing people in our community, and to have them all suddenly collaborating, I think that it could really be amazing what this collaboration results in. So,
yeah, I think as Mr. Whalen said, there's a lot of excitement about teachers working together. It's very easy for those that work in schools to come into school and you go to your classroom and you're very close to maybe the rooms next to you or your department. And really, the goal I have is for teachers to view their support, not just that their people next door or their department, but be able to say, I have 60 teachers that I can get support from. I can go to a teacher in a different department. It's not just next door. And I think the more they interact and get to know each other, a lot of ideas will come out and flourish. And when you get that process happening, new things will come out. You know, it can break up maybe being stagnant. It can break down boundaries and mindsets.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you so much again for the presentation.
Thank you.
Okay. Next up, we have the special education director is here, Lori Farkas, and we have the issue of the appointment or contracting with new special education legal counsel. What's that? You're next. Yes.
About a year and a half ago, Regina Tate, who is our current special education legal counsel, retired officially December of, 14. And then she retired again this past June. And she is continuing to work with us on current cases that we are involved with. So she is really retiring this June. In anticipation of that, I surveyed the Western Massachusetts Special Education Directors with whom I'm in an association and requested any recommendations for continued counsel that people were very satisfied with, and came up with one name that was pretty consistent, Colby Brunt, and shared that name with Dr. Provost. Then I contacted her, did an interview on the phone, and then solicited recommendations from superintendents in the state regarding her performance in special education cases. And we received very positive recommendations that I shared with Dr. Provost, and I believe those are included in the packet, or they are not. They're not, I'm sorry. So I am hoping and recommending that we could, once we start on new cases this year, that we would work with Attorney Brunt on any new cases that come up, and continue any open cases with Attorney Tate. So that is my hope and recommendation.
Okay. Did you have anything to add to that?
I would just add that one of the recommendations was a superintendent who I had worked with in the past. One of the recommendations was a past president of the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents. So these were very highly regarded people who were giving very high recommendations for this attorney. So I'm, you know, completely comfortable with it. In addition to Lori's comfort, because I think it's very important for the special ed director to have confidence in the attorney who's representing him or her in the district in the BSEA.
So so the vote then, is it for
to appoint
as counsel? Mm-hmm. Okay. So I would entertain a motion then.
That would be Colby Brunt, is that correct?
Okay.
So I'd like to make a motion to appoint Colby Brunt as our new special education legal counsel.
Second.
Any further discussion or questions about that? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have a vote. This is at the request of Ms. Walczak, and it is to amend our school choice FY17 budget.
Yes, as we went into this school year, we had quite a few, I think more than usual, reassignments of paraprofessionals. And as we've done that and gone through the first month of school, it became obvious to us that we need to hire an additional 0.7 position over what was approved in the budget. This is directly related to a student who we had budgeted for to be in an out-of-district placement, but based on a number of circumstances, the student will be staying in our district but does need to have a one-to-one paraprofessional assigned. Normally, that money would be transferred from the special ed tuition account where it was budgeted, but because of the move-ins that we've referred to in prior communications, the tuition account doesn't have that money. So what we're recommending is that we increase the school choice budget that you voted by $10,987, which is the estimated amount that we need to fund this additional ESP for that student this year.
Okay.
and you've got attached the a revised school choice budget. We were able to realign some of the accounts so that we don't need the full cost of the ESP. The total increase comes out to that $10,987, and you can see on the back of the actual line item changes.
Okay. So I make a motion to amend the school choice FY17 budget in the amount of $10,987.
Second.
Okay. And so essentially this means that we'll just be utilizing more school choice dollars in FY17,
yes.
Not changing the appropriation, but just drawing more from our school choice dollars.
To me, it's the same thing, but yes,
yeah.
The school committee voted to use a certain amount of the school choice money. I'm calling that an appropriation, but
true.
It comes out to be probably the same
yeah.
thing.
Exactly. Okay. Okay, so any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next, we have the 2016 MCAS results, and this is a presentation by Dr.
Turn around.
Is this a...
It's on the burner. Some beans.
I think I'd really be remiss after that series of presentations if I just jumped right into MCAS results without taking a moment to pause, to just reflect aloud my appreciation of the individuals who brought you the plans. You know, our job is to approve school improvement plans and make sure that they're well aligned to meet the needs of the kids. But, you know, I was struck as I was listening to each principal and parent or teacher come up and talk about their plans to make their schools better, how invested they are in their schools, how they're building strong communities in each of the schools, how they're distributing leadership in each of the schools. And to me, it was just a really amazing demonstration of leadership. So it's too bad they're not all here, but for those who are here, I just want to thank you. So now I'll talk about 2016 MCAS, and chose the lighthouse as the sort of metaphor for this because I think it sort of represents how I feel about these results and how you know I suppose I feel about MCAS in general. That the MCAS is a single point of light. It certainly isn't enough to dispel all of the darkness or to totally illuminate a situation to show you what's going on. But it is a point that maybe tells you that you're getting closer to rocks or you're not getting closer to rocks. So I think of this year's results with that framework. And this year's results are different than all others that came before because I think that light is kind of an even smaller point than it was in the past because Northampton was one of the minority of school districts in the state that took the traditional MCAS instead of PARC last year, which means that we don't have comparative data. The state is not publishing comparative data on the MCAS. So we're not able to perform the kind of analysis that I said was so important last year. We're not able to follow cohorts through. We're not able to compare our results to other districts' results to know what these mean. Because there are, as I said in the past, very sizable differences of group means from year to year. So we don't know if having 50% students passing is good or bad. We just have nothing to compare to. So all we can really do is compare to ourselves and compare to the goals we set for ourselves. And for those who like measurable goals, this is the real data-rich part of the evening. So I'll take you back to last year's MCAS results and what the discussion was at that time. We were comparing our results to statewide results and really noticing two areas for improvement. We wanted to make improvements in the third grade reading score and we wanted to make improvements in sixth grade mathematics. Both cases, because our analysis showed there was a gap between the way our students were performing and students performing across the state. Now, I can't tell you whether or not that gap is smaller or larger because we don't have the statewide data, but what I can do is compare the results we had this year to the results we had in those years in those grades in prior years and historically to give you a sense of whether I think we made progress in those goal areas. So that will be sort of the primary focus of my talk tonight. So the first goal, as I said, was to improve third grade ELA. It's actually reading for all students. And what I'd like you to do in this graph and all the graphs to follow is keep your eye on the red bar. MCAS is reported in four categories, from advanced to warning failing. It's called warning all the way to grade 10, and then it becomes failing. And we were really focused on trying to reduce our incidence of warning. So overall, you can see that we made, I think, really good progress in the third grade at reducing warnings in reading. In this trend, this projection, it's the lowest that it's been in that whole time frame, and went from 12% to 4%. So that also, you know, I would point out that if you look at the group of students who were proficient or advanced, we also saw progress in those two categories. We went from having, just to quickly do the math, 53% advanced and proficient to 58% advanced and proficient, if I'm seeing that. Okay, so then looking at the different subgroups, want to see if that trend held true for all or if it was masking anything, if there are any individual groups that were sort of not a part of that improvement that we saw in third grade. So first grade is economically disadvantaged. Now, we only have 2 years of data on this because, if you recall, the state created the economically disadvantaged subgroup in 2015. Prior to that, the metric that was used for low social economic status was free and reduced lunch. So for years 2014 and prior, you have free and reduced lunch, but it's not the same group of kids, so they're not comparable. So we have 2 years of data on this. And again, I think the economically disadvantaged students showed even greater improvement than the third graders as a whole. Cutting the number of warnings almost in half and almost doubling the numbers of students in proficient and advanced. How about non-economically disadvantaged kids? I think they were a part of this trend as well, especially if you look at that warning number. You can see in 2015, 10% of the third graders were in warning group, non-economically disadvantaged. In 2016, only 1% of non-economically disadvantaged students were in warning third grade. Hispanic Latino students, I think the results here are also dramatic. Again, going from a warning rating of 25% in 2015 to 11% in 2016. And going from no students at all in the advanced category in 2015 to 5% in 2016. Also, the non-disabled students, and this is something that I think we really should be proud of as a district. No non-disabled student was in the warning category district-wide last year in third grade reading, from 9% to 0. And you can see there also are good bumps up in the proficient and advanced two categories. Also, male students, 11% were in the warning category in 2015, 2% in 2016. And again, you can see they're sort of moving from the pink and the red columns over into the two blue colored columns. Also, students identifying as female were a part of the trend. So from 13% in the warning category to 5% in the warning category, They didn't show as much improvement on the top end, but they definitely did show movement out of the bottom performing category. So now groups that had little change, I think overall white students didn't show much change. And one of the things I look at to sort of gauge that is the CPI number that's at the bottom. The CPI basically takes each category, well, there are two categories within warning and there's two categories within needs improvement, and then proficient and advanced are all the same thing, and it applies different numerical values to them and then multiplies them out. So you can see the CPI for white students didn't change that much, but doesn't look like there was a decline. In fact, they did have fewer students in the warning category, but it was similar to prior years, so I wasn't sure if that was so much improvement or just sort of maybe coming back to historical performance for them. Also, this one is vexing, this one is troubling, this is, I think, something to keep our eye on. As great as it was that no student who was non-disabled was in the warning category in Northampton in grade three, our students with disabilities really did not seem to be a part of the students who made progress. If there's anything here that I think is positive, it's if you look at the number of students, you'll see that we actually went from 44 students identified as having disabilities to 42 students identified as having disabilities. And this was at the same time as we were going from a smaller grade three to a larger grade three. So, you know, one of the things we've been trying to do through RTI is reduce the number of students with disabilities. So at least this group of third grade is showing lower incidence. That may in part be part of an explanation for this, you know, because if you are maybe taking out of the group some students who really didn't have as intense disabilities or didn't have disabilities at all, maybe the group you're left with has more intense needs. I don't know. But I can say that the students with disabilities did not participate in the overall growth that we saw in grade three reading. So the other area was sixth grade math. And again, I think looking at them overall, it's a good pattern of improvement. It's the lowest number of students in warning that we've had. And you know, when you look at the proficient and advanced column together, I think it is the highest we've had in this sequence of years. Again, looking at the subgroups, economically disadvantaged, very proud of the progress of this group from 40% in the warning group to 30, I think that's 29% in the warning group, and from 0% in advanced to 12% in advanced. Non-economically disadvantaged also seem to have benefited, not to the same degree. They're starting from a position of having lower warnings and more advanced, but they did also reduce their warnings and improve their advanced. Here, I do think we saw progress with the students with disabilities subgroup. In fact, if you look at the red line from 2014 to 2016, that's a very promising trend going down every year. And this year we had some advanced among that group. So, you know, I'm still really focused on that red line. I'd still like to see that come down more, but the trend is definitely in the right direction, and unquestionably, our sixth graders did better in the students with disabilities subgroup. Non-disabled students, here, again, looking at the CPI, their change really was in the advanced category. So they went from 14% advanced to 19% advanced. You see they also had a similar dropping off of kids in the needs improvement category, going from 35 to 27. So shifting really from the pink and the red into the two colored blue categories. White students seem to benefit, unlike in the third grade reading. You see the reduction in the warning category and the increase in students in proficient and advanced. Again, Students identifying as male made good progress, a 7% reduction in the warning category, and quite a large improvement in the proficient and advanced categories. Whoops, went too far. Students identifying as female also showed improvement there. I would point to the increase in the advanced category. The differences in the other were not that much. It seemed like the other categories each lost a little bit, and they all ended up in advanced. So then groups with little change here, you know, I don't have any explanation for this, but it points to an area where we need to continue to focus. It seems like Hispanic and Latino students did not participate in the overall improvement that we saw in sixth grade math results. They didn't get worse, but they didn't get better. And then going to this ridiculous business of level two and level three. So there are, level three is defined as being at the 20th percentile or below. So this is calculated in a formula that I actually just saw for the first time 2 weeks ago, because I was meeting with someone from the Department of Ed and we were going over this result. And you know, it's like spreadsheets and spreadsheets to get to this 20 number, which is actually a four-year moving average. So you know, there's multiple spreadsheets behind it. And I said, where can you get this? I want to know the calculation so I can understand more about it. And was told, well, that calculation isn't actually posted publicly, so you kind of can't know. But you know, I can say that, you know, 1% away bodes very well for Bridge Street School. So I'll leave it with that for now. The other thing I'll say is level one, you can be a level one school if you, without even being meeting the criteria to be a level two school. Okay, because being a level two school is based on being 21st percentile or above. Being a level one school is based on meeting these targets in the top two categories, the all students category and the high needs students subgroup. The goal is set at 75. 75 isn't a number that relates to anything. It's a part of a calculation that all gets broken down based on your performance against predetermined targets for individual groups on individual tests. But Bridge Street School actually has met the target in the high needs category. And if you look at the individual year, which is here, okay, this is the all students subgroup, which is the other subgroup that they didn't make progress in. And you look at the 2016 category, look all the way down to the bottom what that number is at 75. So they actually did meet the target for the all student subgroup as well. However, it's a 4-year rolling average. So that 75 gets mixed in with the 60 from year 2015 and the 40 from 2014 and the 95 from 2013. So those prior year scores bring down the rating for this year, which is why Bridge Street School was deemed not to meet the target, even though they had met the target. Yes.
John, are you concerned about losing the 95 next year?
No, because it's a weighted average. If you look at the formula at the bottom where it says cumulative PPI, so that's only 10%.
Yeah.
So next year I'm happier that the 40% will be 10%.
Yeah, okay.
But you can see that we would have to really exceed the target next year in order to make the target. Right. So, you know, it's.
Or other schools could do worse, right?
No, because on this, the target is based on hitting CPI scores that were established in 2013. So it's not related to other schools. So similarly, you could be a school, and in fact, there are schools that are in the 80th percentile that are still level two because they didn't meet these goals. So.
And there are schools that are level one that we're performing at a higher level.
Yes, and there are schools that are level level two, that Bridge Street is performing better than, but is still considered to be level three because of the way this calculation is done. So that's why I say that it's ridiculous, but I just want to point out we're 1% away. So, you know, I really think that, you know, even not believing it, I guess this is the message I want to give. You know, last year we were able to make some determined efforts to improve curriculum and instruction in specific areas because we used this data, you know, and that's all I think it's good for. The data was able to show us that we could make some improvements in our early reading, and we could make some improvements in that first year of math in the middle school. And I think we have some conclusive evidence that we did that. I say that because, for me, that's the real reason why I want to encourage participation in MCAS. The one thing that worries me about Bridge Street School is they might not make it because of participation. You know, we've got, for example, Hilltown Charter is level three school now. Not because of their test scores, but because if you have less than 90% of students participating, you're automatically level three. And so, you know, the information is valuable to us. I know that there are problems with the testing. I know that, you know, there are some, you know, students also who experience real anxiety around the testing. But I hope in Beth's, she's not here, but I hope in Beth's coffee conversations with parents, she's just getting the word out to please take the test, because I really think right now the greatest threat to us exiting level three, which we're 1% away from, would be if we had a drop in participation. So conclusions, you know, positive outcomes. We set out to make third grade reading and sixth grade math stronger, and I think we did. Now on the verge of exiting level three, the concerns is I really don't know how to interpret this data beyond that. Beyond we did what we set out to do. I don't know where we're low now or where we're high now compared to everyone else because there's no comparative data. And I think the transition to a new system is going to make it difficult for us to set meaningful targets for this year because we're going from a four-level system to a five-level system that we've never seen before. So I'm really encouraging principals not to set targets, and I won't be setting my own targets with my evaluation committee on the basis of MCAS 2.0, but on the basis of our local assessments, because those are the only things we're going to have any kind of a trend line with. I guess the good thing is with RTI, we do have a really robust set of data on our local assessments that we can use to set targets, and that's what the principals have been doing. So I think we're going to have to go with that until we get fully adjusted to MCAS 2.0, which is actually the next item on the agenda. Yes.
So you were doing grade-to-grade comparisons here, and so I guess one could make the argument that all that change just happened because you had a different group of kids. Yep. You know, the strategies you used explains that difference, but did you do cohort comparisons in any way?
We can't because last year we did do cohort comparisons because we followed the kids all the way through and we were comparing their performance to the statewide averages, and we were able to see some groups were consistently lower and got better at a certain point or got worse at a certain point. This year we're not able to, and with third graders we never really would have been able to anyways because that's the first year that's tested.
But would you be able to say, looking at last year's third graders compared to 2 years ago's third graders, that they were a typical group of kids, or was one cohort stronger than the other based off of BAS or something else?
I really don't know the answer to that question.
Yes, Ms. Fallon.
And so this, when you're talking about this system, the transitioning to a new assessment system, they figured out a way to plug in these ratings? Because you're saying we're 1% away, but if we're moving to five levels, will we really still be 1% away? Like, it seems to me it's only fair to start us all off from scratch.
It all comes down to a procedure known as equi-percentile linking.
Oh, of course.
Which is the state's way of trying to link performance on one test to performance on the new test. Now, I'm not exactly sure how they're going to do that. With PARC, I understood, because you had half of the state taking PARC and half of the state taking MCAS, and you could say, okay, we're going to just set the cut score so we have the same percentage of kids in every category. Of course, except you have the extra, the fifth category on top now. With a brand new test, I don't know, unless the test is heavily based on prior test items, and they're going to somehow equate percentile link to those. But really, I don't know what's going to happen with the new assessment system, which is why I'm saying I don't think we can set our targets on the basis of that.
The trend from different states, it seems to be that they're going towards individual student targets, and whether or not individual students meet those growth targets.
Yes, Ms. Busansky.
I'm interested about the areas we targeted for improvement last year, and are you going to continue with the third grade to target third grade reading and sixth grade math? I mean, it was interesting that you pointed us to the red, but it was hard for me not to look at the pink bar as well, mm-hmm. and especially in sixth grade math, see that, you know, the numbers are still, sounds like they're clearly better, though I agree with what Mr. Baird was saying, how does the cohort compare, but what does that look like for this year? These still are.
Well, I think we heard the strategies that we're going to be implementing in the school improvement plans. You know, we have information now about from RTI about which kids are struggling and which kids are showing that they might be ready for more. And we're just going to try to push all of the kids at the developmentally appropriate level that they're at. I think that's really all we can do, because we don't have the comparison data. We can't put our finger on a grade and say that's low, or a grade and say that's high. All we can do is take the information we have from our assessments and say, okay, where can we try to target improvement? And I think that's, you know, why you heard a lot in school improvement plans about using that data to try to, you know, identify appropriate levels of task for kids. And, you know, all we can do is try to stay to meet them where they are and try to get them to the next level.
Any other MCAS questions?
I have a question. Do you mind a quick?
Please do.
I don't know if it's quick. I think it is. I get your concern around the attendance, and Boston Latin, I think, didn't hit it either, right?
Yeah.
But I think our community is such that there are people who really strongly, with their values, don't want their child to take this test. So are we taking a hit anyway? They're getting a zero on the test when they're not attending, and we get a hit on the attendance, or we just get the hit on the attendance?
We get the hit on the participation. If, in order to be a level one school, you have to have a 95 percentage or better. If you have 90 to 95, then regardless of your scores, the best you can do is level two.
Right.
If you get below 90, then you can be 3, 4, or 5, but you can't be 2 or 1.
But student X doesn't take the test.
Yep.
Are we getting a hit as a zero for the scores?
No, we get just the absence hit.
Okay.
We get the loss of the score, whatever it would be.
Thank you.
And what about, where are we in terms of, are there time limits on how long you can be in level three status before then that starts to become a problem in and of itself?
So the difference between level one, two, and three are all set up by the mathematical formulas that I was showing you, and some of the ones that can't be known, although I'm gonna find those. I know I will. Level four is a little bit less of a clear-cut distinction. Level four means that you're a persistently low-performing school that doesn't seem to be making progress. So the Board of Education can make the determination to put you in level four. And then level five is, you know, the commissioner says, you know, you've been level four long enough, now we're appointing a receiver. Again, it's not based on certain number of years or a certain number
That's
of progress.
Good. I just didn't want us to hit a tripwire because of the low participation and staying in level three another year on this. Yeah, so, okay, fine.
Well, I just want us to get out of it, because Bridge Street School is not a level three school.
Yeah.
You know, if you walk into there and you see the teaching and learning that's going on, and it drives me crazy to think that someone's calling it a level three school. And it also is taking time away from instruction, because when you're a level three school, you're mandated to participate in certain things. We had something happen at our last ALT meeting that wasn't particularly useful. That was, you know, part of being a level three. You just have to do all this stuff that I'd rather have teachers doing what you heard in the school improvement plans. I'd rather have them using their time collaborating with each other, working on the needs of the kids that they have in front of them, rather than, you know, creating all these plans and meeting all these mandates and going to all these workshops that in a way can become counterproductive.
Any other questions about that? Okay, so we'll reconvene.
No, just scratching my head.
Okay. So, that leads us into a required vote as to whether the Northampton Public Schools will participate in MCAS. And is that really a...
It's not whether they'll participate in MCAS, it's the online portion.
Okay.
I did something wrong.
Display off.
In the top left.
Top left. Pretty sure he's sleeping in his way out.
Probably. Okay. So the vote is not about whether or not Northampton will participate in MCAS or some other test. The vote is about whether we will participate in the online version in the required grades, which are grades 4 and 8, or whether we will participate in the online versions for all grades 4 through 8, or whether we will participate in online version, some combination of 4, 8, and other grades. So there are two versions of the test that will be offered this year. There's what's the online version, and then there's what's known as the paper analog test, which is testing the same skills only without the computer. And so that's the choice for the team.
Okay.
So might I ask the superintendent what his recommendation might be?
I recommend that the committee vote to have Northampton participate in online version in grades 4 and 8. It was the unanimous recommendation of the ALT team, and it was favored 8-1 by the faculty.
So moved.
Is there a second? Okay, so there's been a motion made and seconded. It's to do the online testing for grades 4 and 8.
How much longer do we have an option until, and then the state just will say, this is what you will do?
Now, this is all rolling out really quickly. The vendor was just chosen over the summer. There's a lot going on in the online world now because I think there's a concern about fiber optic connectivity, which may be necessary in order to carry all the data for the testing. And one of the things I'm learning is that Massachusetts has been somewhat hampered in this area by having a strong pre-existing cable system, which has really sort of slowed down the development of fiber optic. So my only guess would be that the number of required grades next year will probably be somewhat dependent on the results of what happens this year when everyone does it in 4 and 8. Some schools will do all the grades. I will point out that in the 12% who disagreed with the 4 and 8 option, what they had suggested was just do the 3 through 8, which some people have said to, you know, give kids more exercise and exposure to taking online tests. But I'm just worried, you'll hear me talk a little bit later in my report about our own connectivity. There are alleged solutions using caching servers and other things, but again, I'm somewhat hesitant to throw the whole district into an option that we haven't really tried out yet. So I think, you know, my recommendation is based on sort of the idea of let's try it in 4 and 8 and see what happens. And, you know, if it is a really good experience, if kids like it, maybe we'll be choosing, or maybe I'll be recommending for the committee to choose more than the minimum next year. But I just, not knowing the outcome, think we should probably go slow.
I guess I would just say I definitely appreciate the democratic process, and I'm going to be voting in favor of the motion. But I guess I'm wondering if has there been any discussion in the process around the environmental impact? So if we do the paper option, that's a lot of paper, and maybe it's recycled paper, but it's still paper and mailing and carbon footprint to transport. So I'm just wondering if that's been in any of the discussion.
That hasn't. I did, you know, invite in the survey people to put their comments, and really the only comments were, why not just have everyone do it, you know? Not on environmental reason, but I think on the reason of let's just not,
try it.
Yeah, let's just pull the Band-Aid off and get started with it.
Okay.
Okay. Mr. Reed.
I just also vote for it, and I like that you're including faculty and all team, and but I just sort of have to shake my fist at DESE and at the State House and the whole process of, you know, by switching to computer system, which obviously has its benefit, all it does is exacerbate the problem of low-income districts. So MCAS isn't, you talk about how crazy the level systems are, but they're also not corrected for income. So a really wealthy school or district that gets lots of well-educated kids coming in has a huge advantage over, you know, a very low-income district with lots of kids who are coming from low English backgrounds, blah, blah, blah. And it's the same thing with this computer method. It's a huge advantage to kids who come from a background where their parents are shoving a laptop at them when they're young, as compared to a kid who comes from a homeless shelter. So it's just one more ridiculous inequity that the lack of funding and the sort of crazy DESE system is forced on us. So end of rant.
Okay.
I just had a quick question. I think. So how does this exactly work? So the entire fourth grade, the entire eighth grade takes the test by computer. Does that lengthen the number of days? I mean, we only have certain number of, are we moving large quantities of Chromebooks from place to place? I mean, how does it kind of?
We haven't done it yet, so yeah. That's part of it. I will say that the testing window is one of the advantages of online testing. You don't have the same concerns about test security. With the paper version, you have to administer all of the tests that you're going to give on the same day because you're somewhat worried about kids talking to each other about the tests. With an online version, you can have a window of several days because each student can be getting a unique version of the test. So what I think will happen is we'll probably, at least in the beginning, I don't know if we may change my mind, this is just my thinking now, we may stage the testing in different schools so that they're not all hitting the Wi-Fi and the, you know, trying to get their data through the network at the same time. Or we may go to a caching server model and set up caching servers in each school, in which case then we may just do them all. The one thing I can tell you from the conference calls is what's different from this than the PARC, which was very concerning to me, and I do think this is an improvement, was in PARC, the online assessment was timed, and the computer timed you. You had most sessions, I think, were 60 minutes, and if you had an IEP, then you could get 120 minutes, but when you got to the end, it was done. With MCAS 2.0, the only time limit is that you have to finish a section the same day that you started. So I think that is an improvement.
I'm just curious, will this help the turnaround time? Like, will we, because they're all taking, once they start taking the computerized, will we get those results significantly more quickly than we are now? Because that would be really useful if we got them over the summer or in June, because it's on the computer and the turnaround time should be quicker.
That's one of the potentials, but I'm not going to promise it. You know, I think I'll believe it when I see it.
Okay. Connecticut took longer when we went to online. We get them later than we used to get.
Except that's disappointing.
Because the electrons are slow.
Because of
okay. So there's been a motion made and seconded to accept Dr. Provost's recommendation. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. We now move to a report from the Budget and Property Subcommittee, and I'll turn it over to the chair, Mr. Moore.
Yeah, I looked at the agenda, and I see that one of the items is also on the agenda, the FICR school. So I'll report on what the Budget and Property did, and then, but then everybody hold that in your head, because it will come up next. As you all know, we made a lease last year that was through August of 2019 with the Nonantuck Preschool, leasing the FICR school to them. As you heard at public comment, they have organized and decided to purchase it. We had at our Budget and Property meeting, Paige Brody was there and presented that to us. Our vote is to recommend that this committee surplus the FICR school to the city, with a clear understanding that the city will in turn issue an RFP for buyers who will purchase the property with the current lease, and the preference to bidders who will maintain the current use. So that was the vote of our subcommittee to support that. The next item on the agenda was a proposal from the superintendent for reorganizing how our IT sort of department works and works with the city. And I think the question before the subcommittee was if we supported it, and then by extension if the school committee will support it, so as to do further work on this proposal, which is essentially right now we have, as you know, Angelo Rota is in charge of both IT physical structure as well as the integration and use of it as an educational tool. It has turned out that that is a that the physical maintenance is taking up essentially all of his time. So the hope would be, the plan would be, to figure out how to integrate, consolidate our IT maintenance with the city's IT maintenance. So that would be under one roof, and then allowing us essentially to use that same money that's currently being used to maintain this physical structure, use that money to create a position that would be focused just on the use of technology and integrating it into education.
I would add that this change is coming about because Angela Rota will be retiring soon, and so it would be an opportunity to look at how things are currently run and do some restructuring to better meet our needs.
And hopefully get an efficiency there so that there's not a sort of duplication of efforts in terms of IT infrastructure, which I think we already share a lot of the infrastructure with the city.
We share a common network, but the actual work is performed by separate staff.
Right, or staff on the same network.
Yeah.
Right. So it seems like there's some fairly logical ways in which that could be more efficient, not a forced effort at efficiency, but an actual true efficiency. And that was, again, the committee supports that and hopes that this committee can give the superintendent the direction to continue to work on the actual implementation of, really the hardest part is going to be the consolidation with the city and getting that to be an effective thing.
So with the tech, I'm assuming there are city technicians and school technicians. Mm-hmm. So will they now just be technicians and they could be deployed however mm-hmm. they need to be?
That's correct.
Yeah. And that's actually the idea on the efficiency end, is that currently whenever a crisis occurs, right. everybody has to run to the crisis, and then when you don't have a crisis, sort of, whereas if it's one system, that you'll have a slightly smaller number of employees better able to manage the crises. So that would be something that I think the superintendent would hopefully get direction that to continue in that direction, or unless anybody had a concern about going in that direction. Our next report was from the about the Oxbow. So Carrie Dupre and Lee Felcher. As you may recall, last spring there was a sort of a last minute crisis regarding the use of the Oxbow fields because the soccer club, so that were the primary tenants of those fields, were left to go to the Bean Allard farm. And so the owner of the Oxbow fields, the Oxbow Marina, Mr. Duda. Really wanted to continue in the Mazz athletic fields, but
couldn't do it unless you had some sort of a commitment. And essentially, Lee Felcher, who's the head of the, who's one of the ultimate coach and essentially the head of the Ultimate Boosters Association, the Ultimate Boosters took on the maintenance of those fields and booking them for other uses, which included, I think, half a dozen tournaments this last summer to pay for the maintenance of those fields, and was successful in that. So that was the short thing. The next question is long term. I think the discussion is basically that those fields are a really valuable resource for the school and for the community as athletic fields. And so then the question is, how can we figure out a sustainable way to maintain them as fields? And there was a lot of discussion of ideas and ways to do it. I don't think all those ideas are in place, but it clearly is something that could work. And I think that was the end of the discussion, really. We don't have a set thing to report to you, but just otherwise to let you know that the experiment this last spring and summer was successful due to the donation of Mr. Felcher's 200 hours plus of his time and effort, and that's the piece right there that in order to make this a sustainable thing, we would have to figure out how to replace. And the final one was the Clark School, which is leasing space at Leeds School. That lease ends in June. It can be extended 3 times for 1 year each. We would want to act fairly soon on that one way or another in terms of everybody being able to plan. The basic question is, what is the impact on the school climate? The report is that it's positive, that everybody is pleased with the interaction between the Clark School and the rest of the Leeds School community. They're really very integrated in terms of all the specials, recess, lunch. It's been a really positive thing that way. And Budget and Property Committee recommends extending that lease, and we will have that on the agenda in November. So are there any questions about those topics?
No, that's really thorough.
And that concludes the report.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. So that we then move on in the agenda, and as Howard mentioned, there is a request that is on the agenda to take a vote for the school committee, essentially, to take a vote to surplus the Fiker School property for school use, for school needs, essentially. The school committee would be affirmatively, last time you surplused a leased interest in the property, which then moved to the city, who then executed a lease or approved execution of the lease. This would actually be more analogous to what happened with Florence Grammar School. For some of you who were here, Florence Grammar School, the school department decided no longer had any long-term use for the facility, so they surplused it, which then the city went and RFP'd it in order to sell it. As was mentioned by Mr. Moore in his report, we have had some good conversations with Nonotuc, and they are in a position now that they weren't in when we were having this discussion last year to purchase. And so the way to try to make that happen would be this first step of the vote of the school committee, and then it would come to the city, and I would work to get the city council to surplus it and give me the authority to then RFP it and sell it. And the goal obviously would be to try to craft that RFP in such a way that we could retain the same use as the recommendation from the committee, and that would be our goal.
So I make a motion to surplus the Fiker School property.
Second.
I guess I would only ask the superintendent if he still feels as though there's no use for this in the Northampton Public Schools.
My recommendation remains the same.
Thank you.
So there's been a motion made and seconded. for the school committee to surplus the property. Any further discussion?
Can we say, or is it irrelevant, with the hope that there will be an RFP crafted, continue the use, or is it just understood?
It could be a recommendation. It can't be your...
We can...
Yeah, your surplus vote is either you surplus it or you don't surplus it. You can't make it contingent upon
something. No, but can we, but with the recommendation?
That can certainly appear in the minutes, and that certainly can be communicated.
I would like to do that.
Sure,
I think that,
yeah.
With the recommendation that...
Well, that was the recommendation.
Yeah, I know. So I just wanted to put it formal, though, because you didn't say,
yeah,
it wasn't said in that.
Okay.
So just formally, a friendly addition, amendment.
Okay. So then to let the record show that in taking this vote, that the committee adopts the recommendation of the committee,
yes,
of the subcommittee, or wants that language included.
Yes.
Yeah.
Friendly.
Yeah.
Great.
Dr. Barrett. Yeah,
so the money that the city gets for selling the building, mm-hmm, what would that money be used for? Where would it go?
As I've said to Dr. Provost, what would happen is money from the sale of property can only be used for capital expenditures. And it's been my practice since being mayor that when we've sold school property, and we did this with Florence Grammar School, that we would then earmark those monies for school capital projects. And that's, we used actually the proceeds of the Florence Grammar School to pay for the two roof projects that we did, you know, matching funds for the MSBA projects at two of our earlier roof projects. So that would be the commitment. So the money would go right back into the schools.
Yep.
And the funds that are in the, I know there's a revolving fund that we would, again, figure out how to reallocate that also into the schools as well. So, yeah.
Okay.
So, as amended, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that motion passes. Next, we move on to a report of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. You guys are in the dark. Sorry.
You can take it then.
Okay. It was worth the wait, I'm sure.
It's one, two, and three.
Okay, so we'll now move on to a report of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee, and Ms. Fallon.
Okay, so first up, we have policy ECA. This is a second reading, and we will be voting on it. It is the policy on buildings and ground security that relates to audio and video recordings, which are used for surveillance purposes in school buildings, school buses, and vans, or on school property. there have been a lot of amendments. The changes in yellow, I'm assuming these are all changes that you have, our recommendations from the Rules and Policy Subcommittee meeting to the original policy, and then those in aqua were recommended amendments based both on recommendations from the full committee meeting. For example, questions were raised about what is done, how long is the footage kept, and et cetera. And those were also given to the attorney for review. And then the final amendments were just based on the recommendations from the attorney, checking to make sure if it met the specific needs of the transportation company, whether it agreed with what was actually available on the school buses and vans that we use. So it gets a little bit convoluted, but I think in answer to the questions that were raised last month, the last paragraph has been amended to read, audio video recordings taken on buses and vans was inserted throughout the policy, will be maintained on a hard drive on the buses that will be continually overwritten with new data, replacing old data. Video recordings of school premises will be maintained on a hard drive at the school that will be continually overwritten with new data, replacing old data, and that audio recordings of telephone calls will be immediately destroyed unless an employee believing the call contains evidence of potential illegal activity activates the recording capability, in which case the audio recording will be maintained indefinitely. So I don't know if there's a motion to...
Why don't you make the motion?
Okay. So I would move to accept policy ECA as amended.
Second.
Any discussion on policy ECA?
Oh, I just wouldn't think that you only read
Right.
I don't know. Does she have to make amendments to get the other one in?
Oh, do I have to read all of the amendments?
You could, or, well,
or
could.
You all
could do that, or we have a document in front of us.
Although the document in front of us, for example, doesn't
That's
have vans.
That's why I'm asking.
It doesn't have vans.
Okay, so you didn't,
at least
didn't
that
get
it doesn't
the final
have.
Document? Okay, so due to time constraints.
Okay.
All right, so I guess I should read the entire document.
Sure.
Settle in. The school committee works to maintain a safe and secure environment for its students, staff, visitors, and facilities. Protective devices designed to be used as safeguards against illegal activity and vandalism may be installed when appropriate to the individual situation. Any audio or video recording used for surveillance purposes in school buildings, school buses, and vans, or on school property shall be the sole property of the district. All video and audio recordings will be secured to avoid tampering and ensure confidentiality in accordance with applicable laws and regulations. Release of any such recordings will be made only as permissible pursuant to applicable law. Recordings may be viewed by school supervisory or administrative personnel and may be used by the school district as evidence in any disciplinary action. Covert audio recordings of telephone calls or other conversations are not permitted by the district. An announcement will be made on incoming telephone calls that, quote, this call conversation may be recorded, end quote, so that the person being recorded has an opportunity not to engage in the call or conversation before a recording is made. Appropriate signage will be posted at entrances to the school campus and or at major entrances into school buildings, as well as outside of and inside of buses and vans, notifying students, staff, and the general public of the district's use of audio-video surveillance equipment. Students and staff will receive additional notification as appropriate regarding the use of such equipment in the schools, school buses, and vans, and or on school grounds. Such notification may include, but is not limited to, student handbooks. The superintendent of schools or the superintendent's designee is directed to develop appropriate regulations to implement this policy and to inform the school committee of such regulations. In addition, the superintendent will inform the school committee of any installation of surveillance equipment. And then I'll read the last paragraph again. Audio-video recordings taken on buses and vans will be maintained on a hard drive on the buses that will be continually overwritten with new data replacing old data. Video recordings of school premises will be maintained on a hard drive, strike four, at the school that will be continually overwritten with new data replacing old data. Audio recordings of telephone calls will be immediately destroyed unless an employee believing the call contains evidence of potential illegal activity activates the recording capability, in which case the audio recording will be maintained indefinitely. Now, do I need to move this again?
No, that's a.
Okay.
You've moved it already as yeah. read.
And I just have one quick question. How, because on some of my documents it says for a period of 7 days.
So, do you want me to answer it or do you want to?
Sure, I'll take that. initially, our conversations with the manufacturer, or I shouldn't say that, our conversation with the supervisors indicated that 7 days was sort of the typical time before the hard drive looped around and started rewriting over the old stuff. But in an attempt to be very cautious about this and not put into place a policy that we wouldn't be able to follow precisely, we took the step of contacting the manufacturers today, who said, well, actually, that there are a number of variables that influence the amount of data, the lighting conditions, the amount of movement, are mainly the ones that impact it. So in some cases you may get 7 days, in some cases you may get less than 7 days. It all depends on what you're recording. And, you know, we have different buses that have different sizes disk drives, so they have different recording capacity. So in order to try to come up with a policy that wouldn't have to be constantly adjusted, we just said that, you know, the systems will just keep recording, you know, when they get to the end they'll record over. The real purpose for this was to, since these records are not in the maintenance of records tables that the state has, to set our own policy for how long we were going to hold on to them. And so basically we're just saying here, we're going to hold on to them until the machine overwrites it, if you request access to it after we've overwritten it, there is no record.
Okay. So this ECA policy as revised and read quite well. Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, it's adopted. Next.
This is the first reading of policy BDE, which is subcommittees of the school committee. The first change that we were proposing was to strike item number four as being one of the standing committees of the school committee. It's the conference committee, which no longer exists. The other recommendation that we discussed and would actually like feedback on is because of the change in the charter that aligned everyone's terms to the same two-year terms and election cycle to the same, we thought that it would make more sense for subcommittee assignments to be on the same cycle. So a lot of you are already at work in curriculum committees and other committees in the middle of projects, and in January, theoretically, we would be voting to reassign to new committees. And so we were proposing one of the change be that a week after the first regular meeting in January following an election year, the chairperson shall appoint the various subcommittees acting after the school committee members have indicated to him or her in writing their preference. Each committee member shall be appointed to one of the three subcommittees. Members shall be informed of their subcommittee assignments as soon as possible. And with that in mind, we had also kept, though, that subcommittees shall each annually elect their own chairpersons at the first meeting of the calendar year. So while your committee wouldn't change, the chairperson may or may not change. And then put in the legal language of the subcommittee may make recommendations for committee action, but it may not act for the school committee, and that all subcommittees of the school committee are subject to the provisions of the open meeting law. And I think that those were really the primary changes that we made, but we were hoping for feedback on lengthening committee assignments to 2 years and putting them in with the election cycle.
I think it's brilliant. So, actually, it's what I tried to get to happen the last time we changed the rules, but I got outvoted. So, yeah, it just makes total sense. And particularly if the budget cycle, you know, you're starting the budget process at the end of 1 year into another year, and then you're changing the whole budget and property committee in January. It never made sense to me going to the aligned 2 year terms. It's what we did on the city council. You're on that committee, your set of committees for the term, and it just makes more sense. Especially if you're only meeting a few times right. in a year, and then the committee's changed again, so.
So I'm not complaining, but if I remember correctly, what happened this year was that in January, that January meeting was announced what subcommittees were on, and this is saying a week after the first meeting in January is when that process would start. So I guess I would just ask, like, which way do we think it would be better?
Nothing precludes me after the November election to reach out to people and send a letter and start collecting the information.
Right.
So, yeah, I think that nothing, we can start gathering that information. Yeah. I can do it earlier. That's just the latest it can be done.
So would you say no later then?
It does seem like the language implies it will begin a week after the first regular meeting in January.
Maybe it just you won't always be as much as I no, 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 want I you think to be what, mayor forever.
Yeah, no, I think what it means is you won't appoint on the first organizational meeting, but you'll by the second meeting, the appointments will be made. I think that's what it means, okay. But I don't know.
Well, I guess that's what my question was, because at the first meeting, that was when you announced who was going to be on what subcommittees. I don't have a problem with
it's
that.
Possible.
Saying,
yeah,
this would possible. Say it's sort yeah. of a, this would read that you wouldn't be doing it at the January meeting; you would be doing it at the February meeting.
Yeah. Well, you'd be doing it a week after.
After the
or at a meeting.
Yeah.
Right.
Was there a reason for that? I mean, was there, is there something that we're...
I don't know. I think it may, it could be an artifact of when the vice chair used to make the appointments, and so you couldn't actually...
Oh, yes.
Couldn't actually do it until the vice chair was elected.
Right. And we were striking vice out of there.
So it's probably an artifact from that. So it's not, you know...
What would make more sense?
Could we say prior to the first regular meeting in January?
Following an election?
Yeah.
Not following the election.
Well, what if it's going to be a different mayor?
Yeah, no, I'm saying prior to the first regular meeting in January following an election year.
It might not
be the mayor. Could be different.
You're saying the mayor couldn't make the appointment until after they're sworn in.
Right.
Yeah.
Or you could have the lame duck chair make the appointments and then...
Or you could say no later.
Maybe.
So then does it work to leave it the way it is?
It works.
I think it does.
Yeah.
I think it's too late for me to figure this out.
No, I think that's...
But you could read it.
I like the not later then.
Yeah.
I just think that fixes it. Mm-hmm. If it's done earlier, it's done earlier. Yeah. But mm-hmm. it doesn't...
That would be the last. Yeah,
no later than a week after.
And I think it protects everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
Tomorrow.
Totally. Yep.
So, can I ask, so my other question was, this part about electing a new chairperson at the first meeting of every calendar year, I'm just worried that we would forget to do that because we don't meet very often, some of the subcommittees. But I'm also wondering, could it be that the subcommittee just decides at any point ever, I'm making a motion to change the chairperson of our subcommittee. If is that allowed? And if it is, then do you need this in here at all?
Right, so if someone wanted to step down from the responsibility for whatever reason, then you would just automatically vote to...
Right.
Usually there's a term associated, you know, with it, I don't know, so...
And, I mean, kind of connected to that, why not just have the chairperson the same chairperson for the two-year term.
Yeah.
Why change it?
Because well, I feel like if you have, our thinking behind that, I think initially was, for instance, you all came in this year, the new people, and it would have been strange to vote you in as chairperson with no experience,
but now with a year under your belt and staying on the committee for two-year terms, it is, that possibility would be opened up to a new member. Do you know what I'm saying? Because if we left it at the two-year terms, I mean, I feel like the learning curve's steep enough that you wouldn't elect someone to be chairperson of a committee unless you had no option and you had a complete turnover that had never served on that committee. But this would leave that option open to give people a chance. So I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think we had very strong feelings about this. It was more trying to simplify our lives and...
It's probably not a subcommittee police looking to make sure that you remember to vote to have a new chairperson.
Okay, so is everyone okay with leaving the chairperson language in there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we will vote on that policy next month.
Okay.
The final policy that we'll be discussing, it's also a first reading, so we won't be voting until next month, is policy BGE, policy discrimination. And the revisions really are just updated to reflect the fact that all of our policies are now available online. Mm-hmm. So the addition would be that accessibility is to, I can read this one, it's short. The superintendent's directed to establish and maintain an orderly plan for preserving and making accessible the policies adopted by the school committee and the administrative regulations needed to put them into effect. Accessibility is to extend to all employees of the school system, to members of the committee, and insofar as conveniently possible to all persons in the community. All school committee policies will be available on the district website. All policy manuals distributed to anyone shall remain the property of the committee and shall be considered on loan to anyone or any organization in whose possession they might be. They are subject to recall at any time. The school committee's policy manual should be considered a public record and shall be available for inspection at the superintendent's office. So there are actual print editions of the school committee policies that are available at the superintendent's office, but because they're all available online, it seemed a little outdated to have copies available all over town. Because it's kind of hard to also keep updating them with all of the changes to policies, too. So that's that. Are there any questions?
Bisansky, and then Mr. Moore.
So it sounds like a good idea. It just seems in reading the policy that the second paragraph and the last paragraph kind of go together. The point is that the policies will be available on the district website and at the superintendent's office.
You know, when I was just reading it out loud, it didn't sound as fluent as it did when I read it quietly in my head.
Just a thought.
That happens to me.
So is that a proposed amendment to like just sort of like delete, combine the last paragraph with the second paragraph?
I guess so. I guess shall be considered a public record and maybe an add-on will be available on the district website and at the superintendent's office. And then the school committee's policy manual shall be considered public record. Is that? But I'm happy to let.
Oh, no, it's more.
I'm happy to let your committee hash out the exact.
should we rework that?
It's 10:30 at night. Let's not try to sort it out right now.
It's a little hard to.
Yeah. This is not directly about this, but every single time I go mining for a policy, it's really hard to find. And it seems like it's harder to find than finding a book in a library, even though it's a much smaller library. And I don't know if I don't have any experience with other districts' policies and if they have better organizational systems or cataloging systems than ours. But it just seems like sometimes you have to take a few stabs before you find the right bin when you're looking for a policy.
You know, I think do we have the cover sheet? There is the cover sheet. I think the key is some people don't use the cover sheet because I was doing what you were doing, saying, would this fall under?
Yes.
But really, all you need to do is find the cover sheet, and it'll list all of the policies by name, tell you what it is, and then you know, oh, it's a policy I, and then you go to the policy I drop-down menu. Yeah. I think you just need to familiarize yourself better with it.
With that index.
Yes, there's an index, yeah. Okay.
Maybe that index needs to be more prominent on our website.
I hear we may be redesigning some of our websites.
That would be fantastic.
Okay. All right.
Anyway.
Do you want to read that tonight?
The policy or the
index?
The index.
Did you have a question there?
Can you just note that there is a search bar on the entire website. If you really want some keywords, you can always just put it in there and the policies are part of that scan.
Okay. I'll try it.
To note that this is now kind of a historical document that we don't keep these things at Forbes Library or Lilly Library anymore. It's kind of sad.
Maybe put a footnote on our policy.
There's a piece of history gone.
Any other questions about this under this reading?
What?
Okay.
Can we take a timeout?
Sure.
Yeah, it was in the letter, but if it's not on the agenda, we can't address it.
So what's the question? What's the parliamentary issue here?
That in Dr. Provost's letter to the school committee, it was mentioned that I was going to be discussing another issue which does not appear on the agenda.
Was it part of your report of the committee, or is it an action item or something to be read, or is it just a part of your report out of the committee?
I'm trying to figure that out if you'll stop asking me questions.
It's my job. Probe to the.
It was the school.
Try to keep the meeting moving.
So that's mentioned in the letter. Oh.
You could give an update.
You can give a
I'm going to give an update next time.
Fine. I'm just saying there's nothing.
I feel like we have a lot to talk about still.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think that would be fine too.
Thank you.
Okay. So does that conclude your report?
That concludes, yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Next, we move on to a vote to designate an official delegate to the Mass Association of School Committees annual business meeting. And I'll turn that over to you, Rebecca.
So we have the annual business meeting and conference coming up at the beginning of November. Ms. Fallon will be attending. We have the opportunity to have one delegate, to name a delegate to vote at the annual business meeting. So I'm going to make a motion to designate Ms. Fallon as the official delegate to the MASC annual business meeting.
I'll second that.
Okay. Any discussion? OK,
Please.
Do you order the chicken or the fish?
Do you want a roll call on this, or I'll do a voice vote? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you, Ms. Fallon, for representing.
And congratulations.
I won.
Okay. Next, we move back into the gifts, and at the suggestion of Mr. Reed, we may, and especially given the late hour, we may want to consolidate these into one vote, if you're okay with that. So I would ask the business manager if she could just go through and explain these four gifts, and then we could take them as a group for voting purposes.
First one is a gift with a value of $2,039.55 from Jeremy Whalen, the technology teacher at the high school. You heard reference earlier tonight to the room renovations that were done over the summer. That was funded through some donations from local businesses. It was funded through some accounts they had at the high school, and then part of it was funded by donations from the teacher and the program, and there's attached list of what he did donate that came out of his pocket. The second one is a donation of computers from Smith College to the high school. This is an ongoing thing. We benefited from equipment from Smith College in the past, so there's a listing here of some Dell PCs and iMacs and printers that were donated with an estimated value of $8,350 from Smith College. There's a $3,000 donation from the Jackson Street PTO to be used for the greenhouse project at the school. And there is a gift of $1,215.81 from Comcast Foundation, which is a follow-up to the Comcast Cares Day, where they did the work at the building, and they followed that up with a cash donation to be used for what the building deems appropriate, and they're going to try to put that money into technology.
Okay. So, do you want to,
Mr. Reed, did you want to?
After you, sir.
Well, thank you very much. So I make a motion to accept the four gifts as presented by the business administrator.
Second.
Dr. Baird?
So this is typically when, as the ward's representative, I talk about something other than Ryan Road School, all the gifts that we're accepting. And I did not total them up tonight. And I do want to talk about gifts for a minute. And I apologize, it's late hour, and I'm going to do that. But I've thought about gifts a lot. And I think because I typically do this at this time. Recently we got a letter home for Eva to go on a field trip. And would people contribute money towards the field trip to go to the apple orchard? But if we didn't have $200, then the field trip wasn't going to happen. And so it got some conversations going. And I'm wondering, and part of the conversations with another parent were, nature's classroom, going to the apple orchard, some of these activities, greenhouse maybe even, some of these gifts that we accept really to me are beyond like an extra, like $100,000 for Chromebooks for a school or something like that. They're really part of something that we're saying is important to us. They're part of something that's part of our educational program. Nature's classroom is a great example of that, I think. And the question was, why are we asking some families to pay for these things versus everyone in the town? Everyone in the town is responsible for the education of our kids. And since we're coming to budget season, and I'm thinking about the PTO raising money for laminating film and things of that nature, whether or not it's a good time to look at gifts over a year and think about how much money will we really be adding to the budget and really be asking taxpayers to pay for some of these things that to me are part of a regular operational expense. And so I'm not making a formal motion of that, and I'm not looking to make it something really labor intensive either, but maybe a survey of a course of a year and how much money are we really talking about? Because that $200 for an apple field trip would be less than a penny if it was spread out across the town.
So there's been a motion made and seconded on the gifts, four gifts. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next, we move to a discussion of a possible question 2 newspaper editorial. This is an idea Mr. Reed has put forward, and I'll turn the floor over to him.
Thank you. We voted to oppose lifting the charter cap, and I don't know where this idea started. Maybe it was with me, but writing an op-ed, all of us saying why we think the cap should not be lifted. So I guess my first question is that something that we all want to do, to work together and make an op-ed and put it in the Gazette? We don't have to write it tonight.
My question would just be the logistics of doing it, but also trying to stay within the open meeting law.
Right.
Because we have 25 days, I think, to the election, and we won't have another meeting. This is our last meeting before the election.
That was my second question was, if we did in fact want to do it,
yeah,
how could we proceed so that we don't have to take up much time tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I think one possible way to do it would be the committee has adopted a resolution, and so if some kind of a letter was put together that wasn't maybe an abbreviated version of the resolution, but used the language of the resolution, that's all language we've already approved and voted on as a committee, so you wouldn't have to reinvent the wheel. I mean, I think if you were going to write a brand, like an editorial from scratch, it would be harder. I think we would really have to have the school committee vote to approve it in order to say it's coming from the school committee. That would be the logistical trick. So I don't know. It's a good
question.
Because
of open meeting law?
Well, I think in order to be able to write it and get the approval of the school committee that this is our, we all agree on it, that would be the trick. Yeah. Otherwise, if it was a series of emails, then it turns into sort of an online deliberation on it.
So that would constitute deliberation. That wouldn't be housekeeping.
I think if you're putting out a statement of the committee like that, taking up especially a policy position on a major issue, I think that's a little different than just.
So we don't have a meeting between now and the election.
We don't.
So we really can't.
Can I offer this? So Ed is our vice chair, is our spokesperson for our committee, correct? So could Ed do a letter where it simply has like his own introduction signed by Ed and references our, I can't remember what it was called, resolution?
That makes sense. I mean, our operating,
not that I'm volunteering for you, Ed, but
sure. I mean,
sort of am.
It is our operating procedures that you are our only spokesperson, so.
Right. I just feel like on this issue itself, I think, the resolution was brought forward by a committee member. We deliberated, talked about it, and took a vote. And so it's out there in the community. They're paying attention to the school committee and their position on the no vote. I know there's a lot of editorials, and it's an opportunity to continue to canvass and try to get more people to vote. But I think folks in town, at least, based on that resolution, would probably have an understanding of where each one of us on the board stands based on that vote that we took.
I mean, it could be a letter to the editor just affirming that the school committee is on record, took a vote, voted no, to urge the residents. I mean, it could even just be there's all the whereases, and then there's the be it resolved clause. It could just be that, just so that somebody who's reading the letters to the editor sees, the school committee took that position. So that's at least one way to get that out there.
I'm sorry, because Downey's not here, and it's frustrating me, but the school, this was a legal bulletin that was sent out by the Massachusetts Association of School Committees in May, kind of the language about releasing a statement like that, and I'm trying to get through it quickly, because it's something kind of complicated about you can't have the ballot language included in your endorsement. Does anyone remember what that was referring to? For instance, when they were talking about the measures that are going to be voted on at the conference in November, one of the things that they couldn't do was include any language referring to the ballot initiative. So I'm just saying there is a legal implication that I'm not 100% sure of us publishing a statement that includes the ballot question language, and I don't know what it is, so. I have the document here, it's just not making sense at this hour.
Say, no one to.
I don't think it's gonna happen.
I mean, nothing precludes any of us from writing a letter.
Yeah, exactly, totally, yeah.
Let's go that route then.
Yeah. Yeah, but I do think, I mean, I think it would be, I think it would be fine if we submitted a letter just to remind people, because that, we did the resolution a little while ago, right? It was a while ago. So.
Beginning of the summer.
Just to have something in there, I mean, I know the Gazette is doing reporting on this right now, because they're calling people, they're, you know, trying to get information. So I think they're getting ready to put together some stories about it, but I hope they know that both the council and the school committee both unanimously adopted resolutions. But I don't think they're, you know, so we could certainly write a letter saying, just reminding people that. I don't know.
I think it would be powerful to have a reminder letter like that to say.
Yeah.
Because I know when Barbara, when you spoke at that here, it was after our vote and our name wasn't listed and people were commenting there, though, they didn't know we didn't vote and someone cleared it up.
Yeah.
But I think some people didn't know that. And then it wasn't listed on that day, that information.
Now they're up to like almost 200, you know, school committees that have that. So they're really pressing that point to people. The numbers that are endorsing no on too.
Not to put it on Ed, but could Ed say a reminder, the school committee did endorse this resolution? Would you do that, Ed? Or
sure. I'd be happy.
Friendly, yeah. Lovely.
And do we need to vote to empower you to write a letter or support whatever you write, or is it just kind of?
As your official spokesperson, I think that it's my duty to do that. So I feel like I have that already in your confidence vote in electing me vice chair. So I'll work on getting a letter to the editor out, making a statement that we're opposing to, and that we passed the resolution.
So this has been a good passing of the buck.
All the time.
It's all on you, Ed.
Yeah, I think that I just finally finished reading through that. I think it largely had to do with as long as we weren't using any governmental resources to promote that we were okay.
If you did a robocall saying
we're kind of worried was that in bold at the bottom it said, most importantly, I strongly recommend that prior to engaging in the above reference matters, which may include many traps for the unwary, you seek the advice of your local council. So when they put a bold disclaimer at the bottom, it made me a little nervous.
Okay. Do we have any idea at what meeting date that was? Is that something you could look up for me, Laura?
It was May or June.
Great. Okay, so we'll get something before summer. Take care of that. Mm-hmm. Okay, next we can move to the business administrator report and personnel report.
Yep. You've got the monthly budget report there. I won't run through that, but if there's questions, we can take them. And in terms of the gifts, accepted under your policy, there were three this past month. They were all accepted by the superintendent. There were two to the high school. The first is a continuation of the technology room renovations. There was a donation from Click Workshop of 8 used swivel chairs to use in that classroom with an estimated value of $400. And there was a donation from Proxim Wireless Corporation of 12 reams of paper to be used at the school, arranged through a parent, Dave Reino, at the school. And then there was a donation to Jackson School of $500 from an anonymous donor to be used for professional development or other staff needs.
Okay.
Continuing on to the personnel report. Monthly summary, there were 9 hires. The bulk of those were in the parent-child home program. There was a lot of turnover this year and turnover in ESPs, which was referred to earlier tonight. And then 4 separations and 1 retirement custodian who's been with us for, I think, a little over 10 years.
Okay. And finally, we move to the superintendent's report. Dr. Provost.
Just very briefly, I'd like to update the school committee on the Wi-Fi and internet connectivity issues that I sort of brushed upon earlier in the evening. I'm starting to think of our Wi-Fi and internet project as the sort of musical chairs of bottleneck. First, we didn't have Wi-Fi access points, and so that was a problem. We got the district wired, and then we didn't have enough devices to really allow students to make good use of the Wi-Fi access points, and so that was the constraining factor. And now we've got a good number of devices out there. We're just about 2-to-1, and now we don't have enough bandwidth to carry all the devices that we have connecting up to the internet. We're at a point right now where we probably need to double and maybe triple the capacity of our broadband service. It is probably not possible on the cable fiber that we have coming into the district, so we probably have to make a switch to fiber optic. I can tell you that even if we can do it through a cable provider, it's going to be extremely costly. Going a factor of two in terms of Wi-Fi speed, or I should say internet speed, probably increases the cost by a factor of 10. So we're exploring a number of different options to resolve our bandwidth issue. One of them is working with the city to see if, you know, we can possibly capitalize on some of their purchasing power in order to bring in more bandwidth to the school district. But right now we're in the process of exploring basically a three-pronged approach. One is to see if we can negotiate better rates with cable and possibly bring in multiple cable strands, although I don't know if that's the best, because one of the things I'm learning really is that Massachusetts and New England in general has really flipped from being ahead of the rest of the country to being behind because of the cable that we had. Another option is trying to bring in and light up some fiber cable. And you know, a third option is seeing if we can do anything to further max out the capacity of our equipment. But I don't think that's it. I think, you know, we may have some issues with bottlenecks within the system, but I just think overall it's the capacity that's not enough. And I'll tell you that I receive probably daily urgent requests from the Department of Education to fill out this survey or to fill out that survey regarding our bandwidth, because I think this is, now that we're going to online testing, becoming a very urgent problem across the state. So that will be a focus of my work, I think, over the next several months, as we try to get enough bandwidth to really allow students to use the devices we've purchased for them to the best effect for learning.
Does Pearson offer any sort of money towards purchasing everything that will allow you to use their testing system?
Well, they will allow you to purchase the caching server system that I talked about earlier.
Allow you to? Yeah. They don't help or discount that?
I don't know if they're subsidizing the cost of it. I don't know if, you know, just buying a caching server from someone else would be less or more. but I know that it's not free.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. I now will announce that we have future business and meeting dates. Rules and Policy Subcommittee, October 19, 2016, 3 p.m. Superintendent's Office. Curriculum Subcommittee, October 26, 2016, 4:15 p.m. Superintendent's Office. Negotiating Subcommittee, November 9, 2016. That'll be an interesting date. November 9th, 4:15 p.m., JFK Community Room. School Committee meeting, November 10th, 2016, 7:15 p.m., JFK Community Room. I will now ask the Vice Chair to make a motion to move into an executive session as per the agenda.
Okay. I'd make a motion to request for an executive session in the JFK Principal's Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law, Open Meeting Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining needs, and Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, discuss strategy with respect to non-union personnel contract renewal, Superintendent. Whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Okay, so that's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, I need a roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Yes.
Ms. Ann Hennessy?
Yes.
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 Yes. And now I need to announce to the public that we are moving into executive session because to hold these discussions in open session would be detrimental to the school committee's position on the issues. I also need to announce to the public that we will be adjourning from executive session and not returning to open session. So we can now move into executive session.